real life.
Good Arun evening, sir. Good evening.
Hi, hi. Hi, all.
I think we are live now, sir. Welcome to Ortho TV online education webinars. This is Dr. Shamsul Huda from Ortho TV. We would like to thank all faculty for sharing their knowledge and expertise with all specialty in such challenging times. We wish all our audience a healthy and safe days ahead. We hope that these webinars add value to your time. These webinars are dependent on internet speed, despite we at times unstable peer. Please bear with us for any issues with internet. Now I hand over to Manish Dhawan sir to start the webinar.
Good evening, everyone, and I welcome you all for this Delhi Orthopedic Association webinar on advanced trauma. This is the part one, and on the 14th of June we are having part two of advanced trauma course. First of all, I will like to thank Dr. Ashok Shyam, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani, Dr. Shamsul Huda, and Dr. Ravi Chauhan for technical support, and Ortho TV, especially Ortho TV, because without their help, this would have not been possible. Today webinar convener are Dr. Samarjit Singh, who is a reputed senior trauma surgeon of Delhi with 26 years of experience and in private practice. And Dr. Samarth Mittal, he is assistant professor at Jayaprakash Narayan Trauma Center, AIIMS. I welcome Dr. Sharad Agrawal, president of Delhi Orthopedic Association. He is a senior consultant and head at Max Super Speciality Hospital, Purple Gang. And Dr. Hitesh Lal, he is secretary of DOA. And he is working as a professor in sports injury center. I also welcome Dr. J. Maheshwari, Dr. Vivek Trikha, our speakers, and faculty, Dr. Gurinder Bedi, Dr. Simon Thomas, Dr. Pushkar Chawla, Sumit Arora, Dr. Abhishek Vash, and Dr. Hemant Bansal. Now I invite Dr. Sharad Agrawal to say a few words about the course, and then Dr. Samarjit and Dr. Samarth can introduce the speakers and the faculty. Dr. Sharad Agrawal, please.
Thanks, Dr. Manish. Good evening, friends. I welcome you all to the Advanced Trauma course of Delhi Orthopedic Association. Normally, this is a full-day flagship course of Delhi Orthopedic Association. However, this year, for obvious reasons, we had to divide into two parts, first being today, and the other part, as Dr. Manish said, will be on next Sunday. Today's webinar shall be targeting the region of distal femur and proximal tibia. We have very eminent speakers for both the regions, Dr. Maheshwari and Dr. Trikha, respectively, I'm sure, who need no introduction. The talk shall be followed by case presentations, which shall be discussed threadbare by the learned faculty. I'm sure the webinar shall generate lots of interest and shall be great learning, revision, and update for all of us. My special thanks to Dr. Manish Dhawan, Dr. Shamsul Huda, and Dr. Ashok Shyam for working hard behind the doors to make Doha webinars a huge success. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce the faculty. Dr. Maheshwari, we all know him from his book, Essential Orthopedics, which most of us have read in our graduation days. He is a former additional professor AIIMS, and at present he is working as director at Max Super Speciality Hospital, Saket. Dr. Samarth, unmute.
I would like to invite Professor Vivek Trikha. It is difficult for me to explain Dr. Vivek Trikha. He is my mentor and guide for the last, ever since I started my orthopedic career. He is a professor at JPN Apex Trauma Center, AIIMS, New Delhi. He is a through and through alumnus of AIIMS, having done his MBBS, MS, post-graduation, SRship, and now a professor from an assistant professor, associate professor, additional professor, and now a professor at Trauma Center AIIMS. You name an international course and he's a faculty there, be it a AO course, international course, CCOT international course, APOA international course, and any other international course. People are faculty at various courses, but he's a coach of all faculty at AO courses. When it comes to his scientific knowledge, he has more than 100 PubMed indexed publications. I may not be even correct till date. He would be talking to us about distal femur fractures today.
Other faculties in today's course are Dr. Gurinder Bedi, he is Director and HOD, Fortis Hospital, Vasant Kunj. Dr. Sumit Arora, he is Associate Professor, Orthopedics at Maulana Azad Medical College. Dr. Simon Thomas, he is Senior Consultant, Trauma and Arthroplasty at Sant Parmanand Hospital, Delhi.
Dr. Pushkar Chawla is a senior consultant in orthopedic trauma unit at Indian Spinal Injury Center. He's a very good friend for a number of years. Dr. Abhishek Vaish is an attending consultant at Indraprastha Apollo Hospital in New Delhi. And Dr. Hemant Bansal is a senior resident from AIMS and now a fellow in pelvis tablet surgery at JPN Trauma Center AIMS.
Now let's get down to the business and invite Dr. Vivek to share his slides and give us some thought process on distal femur fractures, where we stand today. Sir.
Okay, thank you everybody. And first of all, let me thank the DOA executive, the president, Dr. Sharad, Hitesh, the secretary, and all the other members who have given me this opportunity to be speaking regarding distal femur fractures in our advanced trauma course of Delhi Orthopedic Association. I'll be speaking regarding the distal femur fractures and giving you an outlook of where do we stand today in the present day world. If we have the learning objectives for this talk, it will be involving to understand the different and learn the different types of distal femur fractures, just to recapitulate what are them, to know the current management options for them, and also to analyze the evidence at present regarding the various options which are available to us. Is it just a distal femur locking plate, which is the panacea for everything in distal femur? Or we are also having other options which are evolving or which have withstood the fallacies of the time as well. We all know that distal femur fractures are of two types. Previously, it was only high energy trauma for us, but nowadays we have started seeing a lot of low energy trauma as well as our geriatric population starts increasing in numbers. And they are having some difficult and some fractures which may not have the same operative options as for the high energy young patients. The margin of error for us is quite low in these fractures. However, the treatment principles, they all remain the same for most of the distal femur. If it involves the articular fragments, it is anatomical reduction, restoration of axial length and alignment, and stable osteosynthesis if possible, so that we can have early limb mobilization with as least traumatic surgical approach as which is possible by us. So let's recapitulate what is the classification. A is the extra-articular fractures, B is the partial articular, and C is the complete articular fractures. And we'll go about seeing how the stance and the principal management options, have they changed, they remain the same, or there are some new options which are available to us right now. The first is the extra-articular fractures involving the supracondylar region. And the options for us have been nails, which were there, the retrograde nails, which were usually used before, but they somehow gone and went out of flavor and favor because of the problems which were associated with the knee penetration and the joint penetration. And people went for that locking plates when they came into anvil. But if we look at them, most of them, the locking retrograde nails have made a comeback for this. And it is now considered that if you have a transverse or a less comminuted fracture of an extra articular type of a fracture, there is the nails like this, which can be done in a retrograde fashion. And you can see the follow up, how the things modulate, remodel, and you get a very good axial alignment. And if you follow the tips of keeping the nail inside the articular fragment and not outside, you will have excellent range of motion as well for these cases. However, the supracondylar nails, which we used to put before, are totally out of favor because of the associated periprosthetic and peri-implant failures, which quite a lot can happen in these fractures. Remember, if you are using a retrograde nail, it has to go above the lesser trochanter. So your 25, 30 nails are a strict no nowadays, and you go in and do the long nails of 34, 36 for these fractures. However, if these supra-extra articular fractures, can they be plated also? Everyone knows how to plate them because that's the first thing which we all learn in our trauma surgery. Yes, this is an old fracture pattern. If you see the condylar buttress plates, which were there, which has been used, and it has given us very good results. The problem with extra-articular one is the length which we are going to use the plate, as well as the screws which we are going to use, the locking or the cortical. And if you see here, even a transverse or a simple fracture, you need to anatomically reduce them, put in lag screws, and then you can have a neutralization sort of a plate, which is going to help you get the results. If you are going to use a distal femur locking plates, which normally many people try to use nowadays, you need to ensure that it is not smaller in size as it is in this case. The working length has to be more. You should try not to have your fracture edges and the screws adjacent to the fractures which are locking. Or if you want, you can also have locking, you can also have a lag screw, get an anatomical reduction, and then go about fixing these fractures with the locking plates. So remember and try to ensure that you are using longer plates, getting a lag screw fixation and using these plates as a neutralization rather than a bridge plate scenario in a complete transverse two-part fractures of an extra-articular fracture. If you see the world literature, what do they say? The world literature also has shown, and this is from 2012, that the rate of union disturbance or the failure is higher in a locking plate rather than in a retrograde nail groups. And this is just a paper in 2019, so it is not an old thing. The present day scenario has shown that even in a biomechanical study, even in elderly patients, the retrograde intramedullary nail is superior to the list plates or the locking plate fashion with the way you are going to use them, because it helps in the axial loading and the plastic deformation which is there is much higher in plates rather than in the nails. Regarding the partial articular or the B fractures, the lateral condyles and the medial condyles, they can easily be fixed just like we fix the tibial condyles, unicondylar fractures. You do not require locking plates for these. It is just fixation and buttressing of that fragment to the intact condylar fragments, which helps us to get good results. The B3 or the Hofer's fracture, normally you tend to go about fixing them with screws. However, this is a paper which we had written down in which we showed that there is an avenue where you can use the plates, and the plate application in Hofer's fracture is usually when you have fracture comminution, metaphyseal extensions, and in osteoporotic bones. So remember that plates have a viable option in the Hofer's, and just screws may not be so good except in young patients. That brings us to the main intra-articular fractures, which we wheel, the C1s, the simple one, the T-types, the metaphyseal comminution C2 fractures, and the C3 metaphyseal articular comminution fractures. First things first, do we need CT in them? A lot of issues, people say we do not need to get CT. I'll say that at present, in the present day world, it is essential. It delineates the extensions, comminution, and nearly 38% coronal fractures. See this fracture which we are having, and once you get the CT, you understand that there is a medial Hofer's or a lateral Hofer's, which may be not visible if it is quite low, especially the medial lower Hofer's can be missed if you're taking from the lateral condylar approaches. What are we doing for the C fractures? Intra-articular, the T types, a simple plate, a locking plate with adequate bridging, making sure that you are leaving the next screw, adjacent screws to the fractures can also help you get good results. Most of these fractures can still be done with an open approach. If we come to the C2 fractures, or where the comminution of the metaphyseal is much higher than the articular fragments, these can be done in a semi-open or a less invasive way, by which you take care of the articular segment and then slide your plate ahead, a long plate, go to the unobtrusive areas, and then can open up there and fix your screws, getting a less invasive approach. A long, long plate, usually 9 to 11 holes, or even in more fractures, a longer plate than that can be used to get good results with these fractures. And another case of C2 You can see the combination at the metaphysis in an elderly patient. Even if the fractures are open, you just need to understand that whether the quadriceps tear is there or not. And then also you can go about choosing the approach of your choice, be it a lateral parapatellar or the whichever swashbuckler which you want. But here, fixing the articular fragment in an open fashion and then just minimally invasively putting in your long screws in the proximal fragment can give you good results. As you see, this is the approach which we had planned, and this is what we attained. Similar things can be done with a MIPPO or a TARPO technique, where the articular reduction is through direct reduction, and then you bridge the longer articular fragment to the shaft, which is through indirect part. And this, if it is open, you can see the follow-up also. Some antibiotic-laden stimulant was also put out there for filling up the gaps. Another thing first, get always two views. This view may not be the right view. Always get a lateral view, which will help you understand how and how fixation has been done in the proximal fragment. We all know the concepts of the locking, whether we are going through two cortices or one cortex, which helps us to get the good fixation which we want in a bridging type of fashion. Is there anything else which we can do for a C1 or a C2 fractures? See this fracture pattern, mild intra-articular comminution, just a long fragment, which is quite high in the metaphyseal areas. Here, you can see that the fracture is going pretty high over it. And these can be fixed again with the retrograde intramedullary nails, which helps us to avoid the problems of the axial alignment in the sagittal view, which is very common in a metaphyseal comminuted distal femur locking plates. The four screws are holding the articular fragment, and then the nail is giving you the intramedullary axial alignment, which is, gives it so better and so easy way that the plates may have these problems. However, it requires a learning curve and also an idea and a confidence that yes, intra-articular fractures also can be fixed through nails. It's the most minimally invasive way by which we can do that. Yes, you see this paper by Corey Collins in 2015, where they have said that the distal femur fractures are not only the intra-articular extensions, are not only the plates which can be used. However, even the nails also give us quite a good results with this. So just don't think of plates is equal to distal femur locking plates is equal to distal femur fractures. There are options, there are retrograde nails which have gone and I would say grown in experience as well as in flavor over the time, and they are being used for intra-articular fractures. Again, a fracture which are lower diaphyseal fractures having intra-articular extensions. You require nearly a 17-hole plate if you want to bypass this fracture fragment. But with a nail and a good fixation, lag screw fixation for the articular fragment, you can have an alignment which is the best in a load bearing and load shearing device of the nails, giving you the axial loading also, which is also not so possible with the locking plate configuration. This is a paper from 2016, which has again shown even in elderly patients that intramedullary nails may be a superior treatment for fractures of distal femur, which even involve the intra-articular fragments, just not the extra-articular parts. As the nails have grown, we have grown in experience regarding usage of intra-articular going through the knee. The nails are making a strong comeback now for these fractures of distal femur. Coming to the scourge of everyone, C3 fractures, this, where the articular fragment is comminuted. Here, the problems of nailing is quite a difficult one. And if this, you see, this is a polytrauma case having lung problems also, where we had to go in for a damage control beforehand. See the CT scan on a external fixator, and you can see how much comminuted is the post, is the intra-articular areas, along with the HOFAs, which can be seen. And you can count the anterior trochlear region of medial side of how comminution there is. Principles still remain the same for this. You get an articular alignment in the best possible way through an open reduction and then bridge it through a long plate, because this may not be so suitable for an intra-articular nail fixations, because the distal fragment may not have that much stability in different planes. So there are a lot of combination of these fragments, and which going through a lateral minimal invasive approach, you can fix a plate with a lot of K wires. And you can see after fixation, you can count all the fracture fragments of the articular which have been reduced back to their anatomical continuity. And subsequently, you use a long plate having 3 or 4 screws, getting the medial as well as the lateral cortical continuity as much as possible, bridging the area in between. And subsequently, with the same fracture, you can have excellent results even in a C3 fracture. The nails at present may not be the best implant for this. The plates, locking plates, still have an edge in these C3 fractures over the nails. However, it is not so easy in distal femur. It's the fracture has got a lot of issues regarding healing, and nearly 25 to 30% of them can have failures of non-union. So what does an ideal plating suggest in present day world? If you see this plating, you have to ensure that it is the fracture time as well as the proximal length has to be 3:1 in a comminuted area. Your singular central screw has to be parallel to the joint to maintain the axial alignment. You are leaving an alternate screws in most of the plates, ensuring that near the fracture, the adjacent screws are left empty. And in lateral plane also, your plate is parallel to the posterior part as much as possible as you grow higher in the length for these fractures. So what are the ways by which we can improve the results? It's the longer plates which we are going to use. 5-hole, 7-hole plates are now not used for locking plates. It's either 9 or 11 holes that are constantly being used. You put multiple screws in the distal fragment, only 3 or 4 screws in the proximal fragment, leaving one screw hole empty at least nearest to the fracture sites. If possible, the nearest fracture screw has to be a cortical one. Now the trend is to put in proximal screws which are cortical or less rigid, not putting all of them locking, because that leads and contributes to the non-union. There are newer screws which are coming up, giving us more flexibility, like the far cortical locking screws, and there are fewer newer plates also which are coming up, making these plates more flexible as we grow in times. The trend in distal femur is that we are trying to make the plates more flexible so that we can have good amount of callus formation, while we are trying to make the nails more rigid and more fixation in the multiplanar concept, so that we can get more stability with the nails. What are the failures which are causing this? If you see this paper of 335 cases, it's the long plates is the one thing which is a technical factor which can reduce the risk for failures. Failures are still a lot. You can get a lot of failures with distal femur plates. And these are one of the few examples which we all have encountered even in our own experiences. So what do we do when we have non-unions or these failures? Is the usage of additional medial locking plates, and you can see this paper in 2016 from CORR, which shows that additional medial locking plate in C2 additional to the lateral one helps us prevent or gain good union in the case scenario of non-unions. So we can have dual plating in these cases, which help you gain good union. What does these a biomechanical study done in 2019 by CWO and his group from Daegu in Korea? They have shown that additional of medial plate adds to the stability, especially in cases where your medial condyle is smaller and also where the combination of the metaphysis is pretty high, making the fixation with the lateral plate less stable. So when do we use dual plates nowadays? There is a trend nowadays, if you see in some parts of our country and abroad, to use a dual plate for all C3 fractures. However, the results in the world still go with fixation with the lateral plate, maintaining the properties and the characteristics which we want of long equidistant screws, flexible screws. However, if we really need to use the dual plates, the indications are in non-unions or in failures. When there is a severe comminution of the medial side with a huge bone void, your metaphyseal or the medial condyle is very small so that the fixation may not be achieved just from the lateral side. And more importantly, nowadays, I would say in elderly patients where a single column fixation or in a periprosthetic fractures where a single column fixation may not be the right idea, even if it is a locking plate. If we see this paper again in 2018, there is an axial defect, medial cortical defect, and an unbalanced fixation, locking plates or using a strut graft onto the medial side of the gaps can also help us in achieving union. This is a case with a bone loss which was there and which was subsequently, which we fixed through a fibular graft and autograft, just giving us a medial cortical strut, which helped us to gain union even in this with a simple single locking plate as well. However, sometimes you will have problems. If you see this, it's an osteoporotic distal femur fracture, which was fixed in relatively good amount and good decent way, but it failed because the patient was bearing weight, or maybe there was a non-union out here, distraction was there, it was too rigid an implant. So what to do in such cases? In an elderly patient, you need to remove such a long plate. Either you go with a longer plate or you go with a nail in situ, but will singular individual nail give you the amount of stability which you require for a non-union? Hence, in such cases, there's a new concept which has come up, which is a nail plate construct, where you put in and get the axial alignment through the nail, which gives you to the stability, and also add a long locking plate, giving you the stability along with bone grafts. So you make it a good stable implant construct, in especially in older osteoporotic patients, where you can get these fixations. Yes, you can see it's by Frank Liporacci, who has said in GOT in 2019, just now, very recently, that nail plate combination techniques for a native and a periprosthetic distal femur fractures is getting in vogue, and there is an early mobilization as along with good amount of stability can be achieved in an osteoporotic patients in such cases. Just a brief word regarding a distal femur replacement. There is a trend nowadays in the world and in our country as well, where in a highly comminuted intertrochanteric fractures, people are going in for a bipolar replacement with a long stem. Similarly, we have found in distal femur all over the world, people are thinking that there is a 20% non-union rate in distal femur fractures as well. And in such cases, in a high elderly age group with a very low fracture pattern, can we just have a distal femur replacement, which will suffice for the next 10 to 15 years and give the patient immediate mobility along with good amount of mobility as well as range of motion for the next 15 years? That is a possibility. And nowadays there is a slowly growing trend of using a distal femur replacement in comminuted distal femur fractures in an elderly osteoporotic patients in age of above 70 to 75. I would say in Indian scenario, 75 and above having a very low distal femur fractures, there will be people, and this thing is going to catch up if we think about and get good replacements for such cases. So I've given you an overview regarding the entire area, where do we stand at present for the distal femur fractures. And if you look at that, distal femurs have remaining distal locking plates are good for most of them. Dual plate has got a specific role in specific cases, and newer options are coming nowadays in the country. If we plan of management, just an overview, if it is an extra-articular or a C1, C2 fracture, based on your own experience, you can use an intramedullary nail, which is strong and has got good evidence in the world right now, along with distal femur locking plates. If you're using a C3 or doing a C3 fracture without much of bone loss, a single lateral distal femur plate, locking plate with good amount of span as well as locking in the less rigidity on the proximal fragment can help you. If there is a bone loss with big medial voids and non-unions, you can add the medial plates and the medial strut allografts which you want. And in elderly low distal femur fractures, try to use dual plates. And if you are a good arthroplasty surgeon, think of the possibilities of using a nail plate construct or a distal femur replacement. I thank you for your hearing, patient here.
Thank you, sir. In the meantime, as Dr. Maheshwari loads his slides, can we have some questions from the faculty?
Can I ask a question, Dr. Samarji?
Yeah, sure, sir.
Dr. Trikha, as you said that now we are going again towards intermedullary nail, retrograde intermedullary nails. The problem still remains over the entry point. Previously, when we were going, mostly we were doing parapetalar arthrotomy to do that. Still, are we doing the same or we do some other method to minimize the incision?
The parapetalar arthrotomy is not usually required until unless you really want to compress the articular fragments to a big extent and there is a lot of displacement which you are dealing with. You can, for the simple retrograde nail, you can go through the patellar tendon, small incision, which we have been using, and going through the same one. However, if you have an associated patellar fracture, as I showed you, along with a simple articular fragment where you are very particular regarding the reduction, then you can use a medial parapatellar approach, open up the thing. It's not the reduction part which we are compromising on. It's the fixation part where it is giving us better results as compared to the distal locking plates, which are leading us as a rigid implant, which is keeping it far away. Nailing, because of its inherent quality of axial loading, can help us get good alignment and a lot of callus formation, which at present, which is a locking plate is said to be a non-union machine for distal femur, can be left and kept aside with this fracture, with this nailing.
Thank you.
Hello, sir, Dr. Trikha. Say, Dr. Trikha.
Yes.
Yeah, hi, Dr. Vineet on the side. How are you?
Yeah, fine.
There's a small question, like when we are operating these distal and femur fracture, which are more complex, maybe I'm sure you are getting very fresh fractures in your setup. But many times we are getting patient effort from various different states and they are quite old. So is there any like time in which is barring us doing some this kind of procedure, like the minimal invasive or TARPO, or we can do in any of the patients?
TARPO can still be done. It is, you are opening up. If you saw my slide, we have been opening up an entire distal femur lower third, I would say, or lower fourth fractures. We are opening up completely. We are going, our incision is above the patella till the patellar tendon ligament, tibial tuberosity. So you are opening up your articular fragments as much as you wish it to be. The only thing which you are doing away from the TARPO is, with TARPO technique, you are trying to bypass the metaphyseal region and then going into the non injured proximal area where you can get your screws done. So you are never ever compromising on the proper visualization of the articular fragments, be it in an old fracture, be it in a young fracture, be it by whichever approach you want. And even TARPO by Kretek also stresses on this point, that it is original visualization, complete visualization of your articular components, be it by TARPO or be it by a swashbuckler approach.
Okay, so that means there's no time barring that whether it can be, this procedure can be done only up to the 3 weeks, no, 4 weeks and all that.
Because your articular fragments, anyway, you are going to open up completely and have a proper reduction of them, and especially in C3 or C2 fractures. So it's not at all compromising on any of the factors which we are looking
for. Okay. Sir?
Thank you, boss.
Hitesh sir and Samar sir has question actually.
Okay.
Can I ask sir first? Should I ask?
Yeah, sir. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Dr. Trikha, very nice talk. I wanted to ask one thing. In the C3 fracture, when you have a Hoffa's associated with it, do you follow any sequence of fixation, fix the Hoffa's first or the interarticular segment first? What do you do?
So it depends on where exactly that Hoffa's is. If it is on the lateral side, it's very easy to fix it because even my plate fixation is going to incorporate that Hoffa's. But however, the problem happens when it is a medial Hoffa's and that to a lower medial Hoffa's or even if it is higher ones. At that time, I'll try to reduce it by flexing the knee, whichever way I am possible with keeping some bolsters below and getting a proper look onto the medial femoral condyle, reducing it properly, holding it with K wires, which helps me to understand where those wires are going to be there. And based on that, then I fix my lateral plate and keeping those 2.5 K wires as the at that plate only, I try to fix them later with the lag screws. If I fix them initially with lag screws, the problem is when they interfere with my fixed angle plates of the distal femur, I will have to change them anyways. So I keep that flexibility with me. I kept them reduced anatomically with K wires. And as my screws are going with the lateral plate, then I decide to maybe change it slightly if I want. Maybe the angle can be changed and I can fix them later with the lag screws.
Sir, I have a small question, sir. Thank you for that comprehensive talk in a very short period of time. Sir, what is your view on the role of variable angle locking plates in distal femur fractures?
I've kept something for the case discussions, I presume. That's why I left few things in between. And variable angle, I'm not a very big fan of a variable angle, as you also know and many other people know that. The problem with the variable angle is if you look at the screw holes, I'm not happy with the distal femur DPS screw holes. They are too close to each other. And if you are using the principle of fixing them and getting the stability, most of the failures which are happening with variable angle screws are because between of the low gap between the two screw holes. In a normal standard C3 fracture, you do not require a variable angle things. You only require a variable angle or try to maneuver your way when you have some hurdle in between. And the hurdle can come when you are having a femoral implant inside or a total knee replacement, which is causing you to go into a different fashion. So in my opinion, the role of a variable angle is limited only and only to cases, a revision case maybe, where you have a good fragment where you want to hold your screw and get purchases, or in cases where there are implants in C2, which are acting as a hurdle for you, where you want to have a variability in your angle of screws.
Thank you, sir.
Samar sir, we can go ahead with the next talk now.
Would I like to request Professor Maheshwari to start his next talk on proximal tibia fractures?
So, can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, let me at the outset say that this is not going to be a comprehensive talk on proximal tibial fractures because I presume everybody knows almost everything. There are some loose ends which I thought are not that clear, and I've just kind of taken those 8-10 points to emphasize during the talk. So, it's not going to be a typical lecture, but more of a fill in the blank kind of a thing. Let me at the outset thank Samarth and Samarjeet. Samarth has been a young, dynamic, academic person who has been very stimulating for me to think here and there, and he has also sent me some articles to go through. And I looked at Samarjeet's presentation about 2 weeks back, which was fantastic, and that also gave me some ideas about, and I've taken some pictures from his talk. So thank you very much, Samarjeet, for that. So first of all, which classification? Classification should help in treatment. We are not academician. We want every classification. You want to talk about it, it should help me to tell me what to do, how to do. Otherwise, it's of no use for a practicing doctor, which most of us are. Now, shared skull classification is very popular, but it has a problem. We have all understood it is only medial condyle and lateral condyle, only 6 types. And we have burnt our fingers by following this classification. We have missed a lot of anterior posterior condyles. Hardly any proximal tibial fracture is purely a coronal. So this classification is out because it does not talk about anteroposterior, and that's where most of the failure happened because we tend to ignore this by Schertzker classification. So this is now, though we still talk about Schertzker because we are got used to it, but I think the more recent classification, which is CT-based 2010, is more logical. It has actually put distal tibial fractures at a firm footing, a very logical understanding of the fracture, where to fix, how to fix, and I think whole scenario of distal proximal tibial fracture has changed after this understanding. And they've given a column concept. So we must understand there are, initially there were three columns, but now I think four columns, one medial, lateral, anterior, posterior, medial, lateral again. And when you look at a proximal tibial fracture, look at these minimum, these four columns, are they injured or not? That's why CT is a must. So today you cannot treat a proximal tibial fracture without a CT. I think you have to be very experienced to understand the whole game without a CT, but most usual people or, you know, practicing doctors must do a CT. It's worth the investment. And you do a 2D CT, which tells us about columns, which column is broken, how much is the intra-articular comminution. So these are the information we want when we want to plan. And especially this transverse section is very important. It's like the picture given previously, which column is gone, lateral column is gone. So you can see from this picture, which column is gone, you can see which column is gone, and whether there's intra-articular comminution, etc. So 2D, as usual in every trauma case, is a very informative. What is very important in proximal tibial fracture is actually 3D CT. I don't find 3D CT so much important in a lot of other fractures. I hardly can orient myself, but I think in proximal tibial fracture, it is very important. Why? It tells you where is the apex of the column. In proximal tibial fracture, we are now fixing columns, and where do you fix is important. So apex of the column is very important to identify, which you can do only by 3D CT. For example, if you want to put a plate here, it has to be here, where the apex is. If you put plate anywhere else, it will not stabilize the fracture. And this only a 3D CT can tell you where is the apex of the condyle that you're going to fix. If your plate does not stabilize the apex, it is of no use. That's where there's a role of 3D CT, particularly in proximal tibial fractures. Now, one issue is always discussed, what is the emergency treatment? Okay, should we wait or go ahead? We always have a tendency to do surgery in one go. You know, otherwise you put a fixator, then do definitive surgery, 10 days gone. In a private sector, patient has to pay twice. It's a lot of inhibition on the part of the surgeon as well as the patient. So what do we do? We don't need to wait for some fractures. For example, Scheretzka type 2 to 4, 3, hardly any swelling, nothing. You can go as early as you can go. Low velocity type 4 fractures, you can go as early as you can. Of course, there's not much swelling. And primarily coronal fractures, some of them are like this. I think you can go almost next morning. So these are fractures where you don't have to wait much. There's no swelling. The skin condition in the front is usually quite okay. And you can go ahead almost like any other fracture. On the other hand, there are fractures where waiting is desirable. Like Scheretzka 4 to 6, I think more often than not, you'd like to wait, because if you put plates and the skin is already traumatized, you can end up with skin necrosis. Polytrauma patient always, because these are difficult operation, a lot of planning is required, and there's no harm in waiting for some time to get your things out and implants available, understand the whole thing properly. So sometimes waiting is desirable. Now, when you wait, how? And this is a very big debate in the mind of the people, because conventionally you say, okay, put an external fixator and wait for 10 days. For a typical Indian scenario, this means in my hospital, about 50,000 rupees for no treatment. 50,000 rupees, 2 days in the hospital, nothing has been done yet. Very intimidating to the patient and very difficult to tell the patient to have it. So I want to avoid this if possible. Now, what are the ways? Now, one way is you can give a plaster slab, but that doesn't help in these severe kind of injuries. And I'll tell you why plaster slab should not be given in the Scheretzka type 5 and 6 particularly. The other cheaper option is, if you're in a situation where, like in a government hospital or a nursing home, you can put the patient in skeletal traction, simple. It doesn't cost him money, because you just put it in the ward and keep him in traction like this. In our Indian scenario, you can even send the patient home on a BB splint, ask him 10 days later. So it saves the cost of surgery, but traction is required. You cannot put a slab, and I'll tell you why. So why external fixator or traction is required, and you can't give a patient slab and send him home? This is the reason. Inside, this is what is happening to the bones. Bones are poking against the skin. If you don't put traction, don't reduce it, these bony pieces are themselves causing damage to the skin. Here, for example. So by traction, you are aligning it very well. Soft tissue falls in place. All the swelling subsides. The skin is relieved. At the moment here, the skin is strangulated at these points. And if you leave them in plaster, actually they will develop skin necrosis in these areas. So traction and fixator is important. You choose whatever you like. If you want patient to be up and about, doesn't mind two surgeries, put a fixator, otherwise a traction. So span, scan, and plan is a good algorithm. You should span and then take a CT scan and then see where are the fragments and then plan the surgery properly. Plaster is not the thing to be done in grade 5 and 6 patients. Now about definitive treatment. So now there are some problems specific to proximal tibial fracture. I'd like to spend some time on this very important slide, very close to my heart. Now this is a proximal tibial fracture, typically a very old slide, must have done, I think it's written there some 2005 or something. Malunion is the common complication. If you know what complications happen in a particular fracture, when you're treating a fresh fracture, you will remember, this is the complications I don't want. Because this is the complication that happens in this particular fracture. For example, in proximal tibial fracture, malunion is a common issue. Instability is another common issue. And these are the patients I see in my referral practice, tertiary practice. These patients come with malunion or instability. Pain sometimes, not always, and stiffness very little, very few. My bulk of my practice is post-traumatic stiffness, but I, believe me, it's very, very uncommon for me to have a stiff knee coming because of earlier treated the problem of proximal tibial fracture. On the other hand, the colleague, you know, just a neighbor of this fracture, this behaves differently. It becomes stiff very often. More often than not, it is a stiffness of the knee in this fracture which comes to me. Or a non-union, as Vivek rightly pointed out. Sometimes malunion happens and pain happens. So you can see the two extremes. In one, stiffness is very common. You have to fix it very strong. You have to move it next morning. Come what may, you can use 2 plates, 5 plates. Doesn't matter. You cannot afford to immobilize. On the other hand, this fracture doesn't produce too much stiffness. So comes the question, you need really very early mobilization in proximal tibial fracture. My opinion is you can be a little slow. If you're not sure, if your bone quality is not okay, you lose nothing by waiting. Stiffness is not a common complication of proximal tibial fracture. Whereas if you mobilize them early, become enthusiastic, you can actually lose reduction and it can go into malunion and instability. So this is an important concept I want to give. Now, how about treatment? So what are the key points in treatment?
And mortality of this.
Is it okay? I'm
having a robust database.
Hello?
Pelvic and acetabular fracture. You also need to have a robust collecting.
Ravi, please mute your Vivek.
This is a humbling experience.
Yeah, I'm doing.
Because
I'm muted.
Okay, so principle number one, alignment is the winner. In proximal tibial fracture or even in distal femoral fracture, you have to get the alignment right. In lower limb, alignment is very critical in every fracture. As against upper limb, you can have some little bit malunion, no problem. In lower limb, nobody will accept any alignment problem. So very important. How do you get alignment on the table? I think you should drape your whole leg like this. I don't use a tourniquet. If I have to use, I use a tourniquet on top of this, either a sterile tourniquet or sometimes S-mark for the time of exposure. And it's you get used to it. But I want to see the whole leg in front of me. Sometimes I even drape the other leg. Because once you fix the plate, you'll be very surprised when everything is removed and this leg looks funny. It looks valgus. You can't do anything now. So drape both legs, top to bottom, and preferably also other leg. And tell me, the biggest enemy is your image intensifier. It fools you. It does not tell about alignment because it shows only this much picture. At best, it can tell you about intra-articular reduction. And if you're not careful, you can actually fix the femur or the tibia in malalignment, which may look very good on an image intensifier, but the limb alignment is not okay. So I think that's one point. LMI alignment is the winner. If you don't get the alignment right, you are a loser. Second point, bone is the winner. And there's a lot of debate about ligament injuries associated with proximal tibial fracture. What do we do? What do we do? Forget about them. There is a high incidence of associated ligament injuries, but they don't need treatment. It is the bone and the bone and the bone which needs to be balanced fixed properly and ligaments will take care of themselves in vast majority of cases. If they don't, you can always do ligament surgery later. So bone is the key point. You have to get the bone right. Don't bother too much about the ligaments. And I'll tell you some about which you have to bother. I'll come to that. Now, medial condyle is the winner. So which condyle fix first, which do that, this, that, don't get into the confusion. Medial condyle is the winner. Look at the medial condyle. Why it is a winner? Because usually it is a big chunk and you can fix a big chunk very, very confidently. And that gives you a primary alignment correct because you've got it at the right place. It's a big chunk. You can use a nice plate, fix it posterior, medial, wherever, but it gives you the basic alignment is the key to fixation of lower limb fractures. It gives you a basic alignment and over which rest of the bones get aligned. And I've taken this slide from Samarjeet's talk. Look at this funny looking fracture, horrible. As soon as he fixed the medial condyle, everything is in place. You don't bother about this. Everything will be all right. As long as you can stabilize this or whatever you do, but he has been able to get perfect alignment just because he had aligned the medial condyle. So medial condyle is the winner. Next, if there is a posterior condyle injury, which now you must not miss these days because you will do a CT. That is the boss. If you avoid or try to bypass or try to play around, avoid posterior fixation because you may not be very comfortable with it, you will go for a loss. Posterior condyle is the most important condyle for a simple reason that knee joint has a tendency to slip like this. It can go into varus valgus, all right, but it can slip like this. So under there is a buttressing of the posterior condyle, you will lose that case. So posterior condyle is not only the winner, it is the boss. So if you have identified posterior condyle, fix it first. Next principle, individual columns need individual attention. So again, if you have two column, three column, posterior medial, anterolateral, wherever, three column, fourth column, all of them need individual stabilization. You can use two plates, you can use three plates, you can use four plates, whatever. But you have to stabilize all the columns which are injured. Otherwise, they will get displaced and you will end up with displacement, loss of reduction, and malunion. And as I know, lower limb alignment, you cannot afford to lose. So you have to take care of individual column by individual attention. Look at this. Somebody tried to fix the medial condyle from a lateral plate. Collapsed. Even if it is LCP, it doesn't mean anything. So, but there are some studies that bicondylar fracture fixation can be done with only one plate. I understand there are some which are very chunky. You can just put, but then I think more often than not, I'd like to fix the medial condyle with another plate because most often these fractures go into varus. It is the medial side stability that is more important because on the lateral side, you have fibula which saves you. But if there's a medial loss of strength, a lot of fixation, it'll go into varus. And more often, the malunion is actually varus malunion. Now, so I call it is a column stabilization surgery. Now, question comes, which plate do we use? Again, you must understand, why do you want to use a plate and where? So sometimes the plate is used for buttressing function. If it is the column which is damaged, you need to buttress that column, be it medial, be it posterior medial, be it lateral. You have to buttress, which is a buttress plate. Now, buttress plate does not mean expensive anatomical plates of synthesis. You can use any plate for buttressing, even DCP, recon plate, LCP, or even anatomical plates. You have to just mold them enough that they can do the buttressing job. So don't need to put expensive plates all the time as long as you know how to buttress that fragment. Second principle is raft. Are you going to buttress or are you going to raft? More often you need rafting because there's a lot of comminution. In this situation, there's no buttressing required. It's just a rafting. You have to lift this and then this raft screws or whatever will do the job. Now there may not be raft plate you have to use, not necessary. You can use rafting principle, which you can use a raft plate. We can use screws. You can use K wires, put 15 K wires here. No problem. It'll stabilize that. And you can use a plate on top of it. So as long as you understand the principle, whether it is buttressing principle or whether it is rafting principle, or is it combined? Of course, then you have to take care of both the parts. So these are the three systems, why you use a plate and where you use a plate, depending on what do you want to do with that plate. That is very important to understand. Next is if there's an extension into the diaphysis, you use a long, rather strong plate. If it is spanning the metaphysis and diaphysis, because that can break if you put these, you know, flimsy plate like this, that will break. So you need a really thick, long plate if you are spanning the diaphysis metaphysis, which can be a strong plate, like hockey plate, for example, or on the lateral side, lateral tibial plate, or you can use a X-fix if the skin condition is not very good. After doing intra-articular, you know, this kind of reconstruction, if you're not too sure about fixation here, the skin is not good, don't take the risk of putting it. You can even use external fixator. You have to just maintain the alignment. So that is the possibility. So you must know which plate, depending on which principle do you want to use in fixing that particular condyle. Now question comes, where to put the plate? You put the plate where the fracture is likely to displace. And how do you say that? You look at the fracture, look at the 3D CT. The apex of the fracture, this apex will tell you where it is going to displace. And we can see from these pictures, look at the apex, and it is the apex which you want to buttress. You can say it anti-glide or whatever, you want to buttress this, and as soon as you see the apex, that is where you want to put the plate, wherever it is, posterior, medial, wherever. And of course, now you can stabilize 360 degree. So wherever the apex is, you have to put the plate, whether it is one plate, sometime two anterior, one posterior, sometime one posterior, two lateral, whatever. But you have to stabilize all your columns. If one plate can stabilize it, very good. If not, don't hesitate to put another plate. And of course, you can't put bulky plate. Sometimes you have to have low profile plate. For example, even a forearm plate, even a distal radius plate you can use. The job is only buttressing. You cannot use bulky plates, three, four of them. But you have to stabilize this, you have to buttress it. And you can buttress it 360 degree anywhere. If you don't take this into account, don't understand your column concept, don't buttress the column, it will displace. So now an example, how do you buttress? Look at this undisplaced fracture of a medial condyle, a very nasty fracture. Even if it is undisplaced, it should be fixed. Don't treat these fractures in plaster. This one just such example out of maybe 15 I may have treated as malunion, they displace in plaster. A undisplaced medial condyle fracture displaces in plaster and malunites. And of course, we had to do an osteotomy and correct it again. Now this fracture, for example, we don't know where it is, a lateral condyle fracture or a medial condyle fracture. I was doubtful. Then you do a CT scan and you find actually it is a type 4 medial condyle. Lateral condyle is intact. Everything is intact. So we just went in with a posteromedial condyle. You put a plate from posteromedial side and just put a small screw between these two and stabilized. So you must know which is the condyle, where is the apex. Apex is posteriorly. Posteromedial plate will stabilize it better. Similarly, this is a purely coronal fracture. You'd have turned the patient upside down and put a plate posteriorly, dot posterior, and it goes. And it is one condyle, but this is the apex which you want to control with the help of your plate. And this was within 3-4 days, you could move it that much. And that is the last. I've seen about maybe 8-10 of them, and we wrote in IGO about this injury in 2014. This is anterior tibial plateau fracture. It wasn't common. CT was not being done those days, and it was missed very often. So I published, I think, 7-8 cases where they were missed in the beginning. This is a case which I got early. And by this time, we were doing CT. So we recognized this is anterior compression where we lifted the compression again, put a corticocancellous graft and put a forearm plate in that on the front, because no other plate will come there. It's a subcutaneous area. But that much buttressing is good enough, and it went on to union very nicely. Now, some more tips. Bony avulsions, you can notice sometimes bony avulsions here and there. You can fix them because they're simple to fix. You should fix them, good healing. But if it is a ligament injury, if you've done an MRI by chance, which I don't do routinely, don't bother about. Only bony avulsions you can fix. Tibial tuberosity should be taken care after you have fixed or in the preoperatively. If it is torn, fix it, because otherwise you will not be able to mobilize and they will go into non-union. Lateral to medial screw length is very critical. I've had a few cases where they were causing pain here because the screws were too long. They're hurting under the MCL. And actually this was the cause of problem of the patient. So when you're putting lateral to medial screws, these screws, very careful. Medial to lateral, no problem. Lateral to medial, they start hurting, and unnecessarily you have to take the patient again for removing the screw. So whenever you're putting screws lateral to medial in tibia, which is a subcutaneous bone, don't put long screws like this. They have to be shorter than longer, and so that you don't end up going again for surgery. Now impingement by bulky plates, especially bulky L plates, T plates, which are there in EO earlier, and also hockey plate, unless you decide where exactly they will go, create enough place for these plates to go. Because we are in a subcutaneous area. Very often everything is done very well, but patient is complaining because those plates are hurting. I think if you're a smart surgeon, you will bury those plates somewhere under the soft tissues if the patient is slim particularly, so that it doesn't have to unnecessarily come to you for a plate removal, if nothing else. Now keep an eye on tibial slope. Now we always look medial lateral, everything, but tibial slope can change if you're not very careful. It looks very good on AP, but tibial slope is gone, and that lead to late arthritis and even in limb issues. No question of any percutaneous fixation in this fracture, because we know we are looking at stable column reconstruction, and percutaneous fixation cannot give that. Now, some other thoughts. How about arthroscopic assisted fixation? Yes, I don't do it now because it is a little bit cumbersome, but there are some patients, if they demand, especially cosmetically conscious, in zero column, where there is a central depression only. You can just lift it, pass 2-3 percutaneous screws, cancellous screws as a in draft fashion, and do it arthroscopic. Minimally displaced type 1 fracture. Well, you can do it also with 2 compression screws. In a young person, you can avoid plate if you're sure about bone quality, and can be done. These are our special situations where patient is cosmetically conscious. Now, one indication where I do arthroscopic fixation even today is posterolateral rim fracture. Now, these are small posterolateral fracture. And as you know, to fix them, you have to turn the patient around, open from posterolateral. It's a difficult approach. You can't put proper instruments. So these are the fracture where I lift them under arthroscopic control. And it is very simple because lateral compartment opens up very well. And then I put 3-4, raft K-wires. I've even put bioabsorbable pins, just K-wires, raft 3-4 of them that kept that fragment there, and it stabilizes, immobilize them for maybe for 3-4 weeks. And that you can avoid opening up the posterolateral side in those cases. And it looks very good inside when you look at it arthroscopically. Even open surgery, you can't do it because you can't see inside what's happening in these fractures. Elizarov fixator, yes. Sometimes they're badly comminuted fracture, like I call them Chura fractures. You can do nothing. No plate can fix it, particularly an osteoporotic patient. If the skin is bad, Elizarov is a good option, or any other fixator option. Primary TKR, as Vivek said, is coming in. There are patients who are 80 plus, very badly comminuted upper tibial fracture. And I know if I put them in any kind of internal fixation from a non-walker, they'll become non-walker. So I think in some of those cases, and I've done 4 of them, where they walk almost next morning. Today we have such strong devices like sleeves, like rods, and you can more or less make them walk next morning, partial weight bearing, and very soon they're on their legs. And if there's a pre-existing severe OA, what is the point in fixing this and patient become stiff and painful? Elderly patient already was avoiding surgery of TKR. This is an opportunity for him as well as for you to do a TKR. Just one such example, which I did recently, was a 55-year-old lady, bilateral unicompartment osteoarthritis. I don't have those x-rays. And I told her bilateral unicompartment replacement. She was avoiding and she fell down. And she broke her other side, one side. One side was still there and one side broken. Now she has got such a fracture of the lateral condyle. Now medial condyle is already gone. I was contemplating unicompartment. Lateral compartment is gone. If I fix it, what great am I doing to do to her? She was anyway destined for a unicompartment. So I told her, now you need a TKR on this. And we did a TKR on that side. And of course, unicompartment on the other side, which was very ideal for unicompartment replacement. So there are situations we have to come out this inhibition of not doing knee replacement. We have got over that inhibition in hip, in shoulder, and I think knee has to be taken the same way. Particularly patients who are elderly, you don't want to subject them to something which has a long rehab, and they will become non-walker very soon if they don't walk next morning. So, but last but not the least, is operation always necessary? And there are a lot of listeners who may be in a situation where all these are very, very high flown material for them. So my answer to them is, if you have a bag of bones, if you have severe osteoporosis, if you have poor skin condition, if affordability is an issue, if your skill set is not good, you don't get all kind of plate, whatever Dr. Maheshwari may say, you don't have that skill set, you can treat it conservative. And I've done that 40 years back, and I can promise you, if you know how to do a good conservative treatment in this kind of situation, you'll get fairly good results. So don't get hooked on to all kind of courses and big big talks about everything. But so you remember, when she was good, she was very, very good. When she was very, very horrid. So don't end up in a situation where you do surgery for these kind of fractures. You don't have the skill. You don't have the everything available. You do it and you'll end up with unnecessary, endless problems. It's okay to put a tibial traction, put it in, you know, in a BB splint, take AP lateral view. And as I told you, 4 to 6 week of immobilization in traction is not going to do much harm. This patient will be happy. You have maintained alignment. And so-called osteoarthritis because of not a perfect reduction of the articular surface is also a theory. I don't think it gives rise to osteoarthritis too soon. Sir, with that, I want to thank my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Maheshwari. Thank you for such an elaborate presentation. There is a question for you. Dr. Maheshwari, though you have mentioned in one slide, in Shadgar 5 and 6, due to severe trauma, Dr. Maheshwari, are you listening?
Yeah.
In Shadgar 5 and 6, due to severe trauma, there are skin problems and often there is a blister formation. Now, is there any role of Elisrof? Though you have mentioned in your slide, can there be Elisrof provide a primary definitive treatment as the wires, they decompress the compartment and you don't need to wait for definitive plate fixation?
Definitely. I think there is a role of hybrid treatment where you reconstruct the joint with small plate or maybe compression screws and use an external fixator to neutralize that area. Particularly in a situation where you can expect that the skin will not heal up for say maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, there's no harm in putting an external fixator of some kind, maybe an Elisrof. I agree with you.
Okay. Dr. Samar, we can go for the case presentation.
Can I have one question?
Yeah, Dr. Vineet. Yeah.
Maheshwari sir, thanks for nice presentation. The small question which I want to know, most of the time when we have these kind of high velocity trauma involving the proximal end of tibia, we do have ligament injuries also, including MCL or LCL. So is it necessary to treat those ligaments in the simultaneously or should we wait for them? What should the protocol?
So when there is a severe bone injury, ligaments injuries are cosmetic. They are there. If you do an MRI, you just have to. So after you have fixed your fracture, in case you have fixed it, just do a gentle medial lateral mobility. Only your collateral should be stable. If there is a big movement, that means there is an MCL injury, just brace it for 2-3 weeks. As you would understand, all ligament injuries give rise to instability when the knee is very pliable and very flexible. Fortunately, because of this trauma, so much adhesions happen in all that area that all those ligaments injuries do nothing. They mean nothing. The knee becomes stable. And if at all it is unstable later on, you can go in and do it secondary surgery. So no primary surgery for ligament, except if you want to fix avulsions, which are simple things to do. You can do it, but no ligament surgery otherwise.
Thank you very much, sir.
Dr. Samar, please tell Dr. Simon to...
Simon, please start. He is a senior consultant in Delhi Institute of Trauma, Sant Paramanand Hospital. So he is presenting a case on proximal tibia. This will carry our discussion forward as we are presenting the cases. Whatever the concept Dr. Maheshwari has given, that will carry forward with the cases. Dr. Simon, please.
Yeah, we can take case presentation and the questions together. Each case we can have. Okay. Dr. Simon, please.
Just wait, I'm unmuting him. Actually, he's muted himself.
Dr. Simon, we can't hear you. Just stop. Dr. Simon, we can't hear you. Unmute yourself.
Yeah, I made him unmute.
Dr. Simon, now you can start.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. I was almost half muted by Dr. Maheshwari's talk and the computer did rest of the job. And I'm going to today present a case. And this is a 57-year-old male gentleman. He has presented with this X-ray 2 hours post-operatively. So he's just had a road traffic accident and this is 2 hours. There are no googlies here. He has no other injuries and no distal neurovascular deficit. I have not presented the rest of the X-rays of the pelvis and the tibia and the femur, but these, they were all normal. So to take the this thing, issues here. See, if for any trauma case that we deal as practitioners, I think it matters. What matters is, first of all, doing an initial assessment, which I have done and told you there's nothing, no googly here. So now the patient comes to you in the casualty. And my question to some of the panelists are going to be, would you like to aspirate the knee, put some local anesthesia, and make the patient more comfortable? Dr. Maheshwari has already answered that one question, that giving an initial cast is not going to help in any way. So I think that one question is answered. Any takers for aspirating the knee? Or do you think it does not matter?
Let's start with Dr. Maheshwari for the first thing, and maybe then the next. Dr. Maheshwari, sir.
So if it is a tense hematoma, there's no harm in aspirating it. It relieves the pain. I think if it is a very tense hematoma, and patient gets very relieved as soon as you aspirate. So I do that.
Okay, that's great. I think that is one thing, that once a patient comes to you in the casualty, if you aspirate, put a lignocaine, the patient gains a lot of confidence in you and you are more convincing because pain is relieved. Now, when to operate? That is one question which I always ask myself. Although Dr. Maheshwari said about the low velocity injuries, you know, not having any blisters, but I often see that some of the patients whom I see on the day of injury, I tell them I'll most probably operate you tomorrow. But when I come back the next day, I find a few blisters. They may not be very, very, you know, bad, but there are still blisters. And so any way to predict which fractures, other than the fracture pattern, any way to predict which fractures are going to throw blisters and which are not?
Can I ask Dr. Lalit to give an opinion on this, please?
And one more thing, are there any ways in which you can actually prevent fractures developing a blister? Is there any way in which you can prevent that?
So aspiration for me is no. And the second part of the answer is icing and elevation. So both of the things would help in pain as well as blister formation. Simon?
Do you have any things by which you predict that this fracture is going to have a blister tomorrow? Or you're confident in asking your resident to go and operate it on the next day? And one more question. Would you ask these fractures to be operated on the same day?
No, not in my certain type of a setup. They don't get operated on the same day. And upper tibia, we're always worried. You know, it is a subcutaneous bone and we always like to observe. And even the most innocuous looking do swell up with time, and it's not a bad idea to wait.
Dr. Maheshwari, you work in the best of setup. You've got a team which can operate in the middle of the night. Would you advise any fracture to be fixed at the middle of the night?
First of all, my residents will not do this case. And so because I will do it, I will always do it tomorrow morning minimum. But I agree with you, the blister will depend on the skinniness of the patient also. If the patient is very skinny, it might be huge hematoma there. I will wait even in this fracture. Sometimes the skin looks quite good and is a bulky kind of a fat is there subcutaneous, but I will operate next morning, not in the same day, because I need CT, I need to plan, and they may look simple. It may be lateral and posterior and whatever. So it's not a simple case as it appears.
Absolutely. I will not ask the next question about who wants a CT, because we are categorical on that this patient requires a CT scan. Intra-articular fractures, they require a CT scan, so there is no question whether we need it or not. Plan of surgery. Maheshwari sir, what is your, or anybody else who wants to give?
Can I ask Dr. Hitesh, normally how do you plan to lift up this depressed fracture which you are seeing on the articular side? Do you go through the fracture site and lift it up? Or you make a different window and lift from that with an elevator?
In this case, I will go through the fracture site, open the book and elevate the fragment, and then fix it provisionally and see for the reduction by C-arm. There is not a split wedge fracture, then I will locate a window from the opposite side.
Do you normally, when you open up and see that small, thin slice of articular surface, you take some normal bone beneath? And lift.
Yeah, I will take a normal bone beneath it and
wedge it up. And then jack it up and.
Yeah.
And then what sort of a fixation?
This will require a plating, locking plate with a normal fixation.
Can I ask Dr. Bedi, do you do a rafting in such sort of a cases, and rafting through the plate or out of the plate?
So I think I would lay off. I find it much easier actually to stabilize the articular fragment because a lot of them are slightly on the thinner side. So I would do a rafting outside the plate and then put another plate on this side to stabilize it. So my fracture is, my articular fragment is fixed by the time I come to put the plate.
I think I'll have to put in one point that before, you know, 5 years back, 6 years back, when we did not have these good raft plates, actually raft screws outside the plate was a good idea. It still is. I'm not saying it is not a good idea. But the thing is that now we've got wonderful plates, which gives you almost four raft screws in going through that plate. It gives you angular stability and that fragment is very well buttressed from coming down again. So in my practice, almost always the raft screws are through the plate itself. And I used a raft plate.
Dr. Bedi, asking, taking the same thing forward, when we are using a raft plate, the raft plate is a fixed angular construct. If the depression is more posterior, can you really go back there and raft it beneath, or you like to do a separate rafting and then put in a plate as a buttress?
So the posterior fragments are very, very difficult. So you're totally dependent then on the on the plate to help you out. So if the question is, if the fragment is very posterior, how do I raft it? Is that the question?
Yeah, sort of means sometimes, see, the plate is more anterolateral. So it is not exactly total posterior, more of mid-posterior sort of a thing.
Yes.
Plate will only give a fixed construct underneath it. And so that sort of raft may not support the depressed fracture as it is. That was the question I wanted to ask.
That's the reason why I've actually taken to, I mean, I know the especially the Smith and FU periarticular is actually wonderful because of the direction of the thing, but it will obviously sometime miss. So that's the reason why I've taken to putting some 3.5 cortical screws as rafts and then putting my plate. That's the reason that I use.
Gurinder, when you put a raft screw from outside, the hold at that rafting function of that screw will depend on how securely the head of the screw is held in that lateral fragment, which is not a good quality bone there. Whereas if you pass it through the plate, it's a locking screw. It kind of cannot angulate at all. Once you put it there, it is there. Whereas if you put a screw outside the plate, you know, the what is holding that raft?
I agree, Chief. That's what I felt. But then I think the plate actually compensates for whatever little that is. It's actually more for the subchondral bone support that I use it. Basically, because I'm insecure that the screws will go where they want to grow from the plate. So I just put it there. Just to be sure that at least those fragments, which I think I do it, but I totally agree with you. The cortex is normally very thinned out, not sufficient to give me a very good hold. And I'm not disagreeing with that.
Any role of bone grafting now in this? Or now with the onset of the availability of raft plates, bone grafting is out?
More or less out.
In this fracture, let's talk about this fracture. In this fracture, would you want a bone grafting to be done?
I mean, it all depends on what it looks like once you've got the condyle out. But I don't leave. For me, for a weight bear, for this, I know people take simile of taking it down to the calcaneum. But for me, I like the idea of putting some sort of a graft in there. I'm not saying which type, some sort of a graft. I know the controversies, but I would rather fill it up. It actually helps me actually almost reduce the fragments.
This is how the CT.
Simon, can you finish the case?
Yes.
Because we're getting short of time, please.
Okay, this is how the CT looks like. Although the CT gives you more idea, but it is mandatory, we know. And what additional info, I'll tell you. But before that, pre-operative counseling of these patients is made much easier by the CT scans, especially in private practice. The X-ray looks subtle, but if you see the CT scan, it is a much more worse deformity and a defect, which is rather than what it looks on the X-ray. And if you, actually, Dr. Maheshwari went through all this, if you see the transverse views, you see it is a posterolateral part of the condyle which is involved. So you get a three-dimensional view of where your defect exactly is. And again, in this view, we know it is mainly in the posterior part. And it points out to the location of the defect and it helps me execute this surgery better. And this is how it is. And this is what Dr. Samarjeet was mentioning. See, this is an anterolateral plate. Although I put a raft screw, four raft screws through the plate, but the majority of the screws are, you know, the first front screws are going well anterior. So we may not have adequately rafted these the fragments that we want. So like Dr. Bedi mentioned, this may be one scenario in which he would likely want to have one more screw or maybe two more screws rafting outside the plate. And both of them will, you know, all both of them will supplement each other. The post-operative, I don't give them a cast or anything. I mobilize the next day and they are toe-touch ambulation for some time. And I expect to have good range of movement here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Simon. I would now like to request Dr. Pushkar to put up his next case on proximal tibia fracture.
Just a minute. Simon, sir, it was really nice. Just a comment on that. We can put that plate more posteriolaterally under that lateral collateral ligament, just over that fibula, that same plate, we can place it a little more posterior to raft our posterior area also. If you do a little careful dissection on the posterolateral side under the lateral collateral ligament, you can put your plate there and you can do that rafting there also.
Dr. Pushkar, load your slides.
Yes, sir. It's loaded there. So starting here, sharing my slides. Sir, here on the slide. It's a young male, sir. Can you all see? Can you all hear? Yeah. So young male going through the similar scenario. RTA had this patient has a cervical spine injury also, whiplash kind. So he was operated for the cervical spine. He has a medial kind, not bad looking X-rays, not dislocated. So we have just given it a temporary slab. Check it out regularly for any kind of blisters. So luckily there was no blister, waited for 7 days. And this is the X-ray, AP and lateral view. So X-ray is this. And now we have done the CT scan in the meanwhile. This is the CT scan, all the axial cuts and the down and then the sagittal and the coronal cuts. Anybody wants to comment? Anybody wants to see anything?
Dr. Bedi, can you please take up this case, sir?
Bedi, sir.
I'll just, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Aur tune to iska badi halat kar di isme. This is going to be difficult. Okay, let's go. So the main fragment is the medial fragment. There is a depression in the middle. So most likely the ACL kind of an area is there. My approach for this would be to, I mean, obviously have a look at all the CT scans which are available. I'm going to go for my postromedial approach. I'm just trying to see how do I get to those fragments in between and what I can do, because although the axial cut, the fragments are very small, very displaced on the X-rays, they don't look as bad. There is an articular fragment in between. So I think I'll have to go from there and then I'll have to push up, because if you look at the X-ray, you can see an articular fragment which is lying perpendicular to the
So this
plane.
Is, yeah, sir.
Oh, sorry, that's exactly, one. Yeah. Sir. So yeah, this one is what I need to, and I'm sure I can actually get it elevated from the back only, lifting it up and getting it from the back. Some of it is going to be the attachment of the ligament. My personal take is, just like Dr. Maheshwari, not to attempt to do anything to that. So do that and elevate the fragments as much as I can. Put some wires, have a check, looks okay, put a plate perpendicular to the main fracture line which is there, and hope that I can subcondral raft the other fragments.
Excellent, sir. Excellent, sir. Absolutely. Anybody else wants to comment?
I want to is one of the middle fragment. If you see the lateral view,
sir,
the lateral view, the AP view, there is a fragment there, right?
Yes, sir.
Sometimes these fragments are very nasty. Sir. They don't allow reduction.
Sir.
So if you are not getting the reduction right, you may have to just shoo them away somewhere here and there so that you can get the reduction. Also, after getting the reduction, look at the anterior tibial spine. If that is elevated, that's one thing you have to just maybe poke it down. You don't have to fix it, but put it in proper place. So I think reduction is an issue sometimes because of these small fragments which are in between the fracture line.
Sir, if we see this lateral axial cuts, the bone reduction is not bad. This cut is really not bad. So it's already reduced. So just need the alignment right, as you only have said, get the alignment right. And this is a large piece of the medial side, medial condyle. So maybe posterior. Only concern regarding this is how you approach this to lift off. If suppose you want to lift it off, then how you can lift this off. Either through medial, as the Dr. Bedi sir has said, Going through intra-articular reduction may be a little difficult. Then we have other approach like Frosch approach, maybe postulatal. Then we need medial again. Or something we go in a prone and do so same, the medial and lateral postulatal approach. Anybody would have a comment on this? Or shall I go forward?
Yeah, so I think move forward for a little
time. Idea is not to do an articular reduction. Idea is get this away.
Okay. I would want to know the power in the knee joint.
Yeah, it's a non-articular area.
Okay. So we thought, let's try and reduce it. So we have gone in a lying the patient prone, and this is the medial approach. This is the fibula which we have marked, and we've gone through the postulatal approach straight from the top. And because this is an intra-articular reduction, as the Leo has said, so you have to define now three things in this. Which is your column? Where is going to put your plate there on the column? Where is your intra-articular reduction? So, and how you're going to approach it? So I'm going to approach it through the posterior lateral independent approach. I put this turn it down so that how my knee I'm going to approach there. So to lift it off this piece also, and how I'm going to fix this in the final. So this is my piece. So I've gone through the posterior lateral first, lifted off the capsule, gone through the submeniscal approach here also, and try to retract the soleus and lifted off the popliteus muscle and the lateral gastrocnemius to one side, lift it off, try to lift it off and place that pieces there back and fixed up temporarily with the wire. Then gone to the medial side to reduce my alignment, to check my alignment right, get my alignment right. Then start fixing from the medial side first, get my alignment right. And this is how I achieved on the medial side, or one medial side, because it's a large medial side fracture. So I need to fix it from the posterior side and from the medial side. Now, these fixation, because I thought I may go for a smaller plate, but as I was going from the posterior side, there was not much of a space between fibula and my this plate. So I am not able to do this. And so then I will fix it with a screw from the medial to lateral side, which is setting up over this lateral intact condyle and this screw over that central screws. So that is giving me a roughing there to these screws. And this is the final X-ray I achieved after 8 weeks of time. Any comments, sir?
Well, I think one point I want to make,
sir.
As you can see, in spite of the two plates, your medial condyle is in varus.
Right, sir. Exactly, sir.
I think that's
why I missed that. Yeah, exactly.
No. So when you are, the point is, when you are reducing these fractures from posterior medial or posterior approach,
sir,
lot of time at the apex there is a comminution. Sir. Don't bother about the apex reduction. The apex may look hairline reduction. Still, it may be varus. So please always see in the image whether your condyle is properly reduced. Sometimes you have to actually over-reduce it to get the varus correction.
Sir. Sir, only comment is this. Sir, as we are routinely seeing in an AP, position, in an anterior position, patient is lying supine. And once we have done it in a prone, a little difficult in seeing that alignment right, because it's a tunique above and the patient is lying down on a supporter to lift up the pelvis, so may not be able to get that alignment right. So we have tried to reduce it, as the Maheshwar said, get the alignment medial side, which is not right here. But okay, this is, I have learned here. Samar sir wants to say something.
How would you avoid this in future? What is the take for the other people?
Okay, so as you have said, try to do over reduction on the medial side. Try to get the reduction right and check it again and again before finalizing your fixation there.
So one tip I want to give is, you take a similar X-ray of the opposite side on the table, just freeze it on the image. That's your template. That will immediately tell you where this condyle is, because, or you have a normal X-ray available in case you have done it before. But on the table, take a X-ray of the normal side,
sir,
and put it there on the image.
That's a good idea, sir.
That's a good idea.
Sir, Maheshwari, sir, would you do it the same way or would you use a single plate in this patient?
I would have used a single plate because that lateral condyle was there, but it wasn't contributing too much to the articular margin. And I think probably a posteromedial or one plate would have been good enough, according to me.
Sir, one plate, I may be wrong in getting that alignment right, but I think one plate is not sufficient, as it's a large bit medio posterior, full fragment. One plate may not be going to hold it to your varus reduction. So
I'll go to the CT. I don't know. I've not seen the CT properly, but it'll. I don't hesitate to put two plates.
Okay. Right. Sir.
Thank you, Dr. Pushkar.
Thank you, sir.
Can I ask Dr. Hemant Bansal to load his slides?
Yes, sir. It's ready.
In the meantime, if there is any question from the audience or any comment from faculty.
Can I make a comment?
Yeah, sir.
One tip of getting this varus right in this type of a fracture is you put a subchondral wire from the lateral side. Put it in a way that it is perpendicular to the diaphysis. And you are not entered the medial condyle. So we have put a wire perpendicular to the diaphysis of the tibia, subchondral to the lateral condyle. So when you are elevating your medial condyle, you have a reference line over there which keeps telling you. This is one of the tips described by the Drawer Pallais technique in deformity correction. He does this. He puts a wire from the lateral side and keeps lifting his medial condyle. And when he's happy, the wire is forwarded and it captures the medial condyle also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. It's
Good, very nice.
Shall I start, sir?
Yes. Yeah, sure.
So good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the Delhi Orthopedic Association and my mentors, Professor Vivek Trikha, sir, and Dr. Samad, sir, to provide me this opportunity to share my views on this wonderful platform in front of all the senior faculties over here. So as we have discussed a lot of things regarding proximal tibia management, Dr. Maheshwari has elaborated all the management aspect of the proximal tibia. Here, I'll be having something out of the typical fracture presentation. So this is a presentation regarding a 23-year-old male who is a college student basketball player. He sustained road traffic accident and he injured his right knee while driving.
Dr. Hemant.
Yes, sir.
Kindly share your slides.
Your slides are not moving and please put your slides in the play mode.
Now my screen is there, sir.
Yeah, screen is there. Just maximize it in the play mode. Yeah.
Yes. Is it there now?
Yeah, it is, but it is not in the full screen mode. Not yet.
You come at the bottom
of
the
right. Take it to the slideshow on the side.
There is a mark on slideshow.
Yeah, take it to there. Yeah.
Yeah, start it.
Yeah,
start
that's it.
Still there, sir?
Dr. Hemant, there is one thing. You can just reopen it as Dr. Samarth is saying, and the next is the on the view, just improve the size of the view. It is 50%, I think. Normal view. Put it normal. Just unshare it and share it again, please. Now it's okay. Just maximize your screen.
Now it's okay, sir?
Yeah. Just maximize your screen now.
It's clear, sir?
Yes, it is clear now.
Close and reopen.
Please close and reopen it. Now reopen it, please.
In the meantime, can I ask a question from Dr. Maheshwari?
Sir, please go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Dr. Maheshwari, we have been, classically taught that proximal tibia is more forgiving, more so the lateral condyle than the medial condyle. Compared to like distal femur and other bones. Now, yes. If there is a depressed fracture of the lateral condyle, how much will you accept without operating? There are different views, some 2 millimeter for 5 millimeter, 10 millimeter. And how will you conclude whether you're going to operate that case or not going to operate, or are you going to operate all the cases?
So there are two things that will decide. One is your column has to be in place. That means your outer border of the tibia is in alignment with the outer border of femur. If that is there, there is no instability. There are two problems. One is problem of instability.
One mute or something?
Can I start now?
Yes, sir, you can start. You can start the same way.
Let Maheshwari, sir, give the answer to Dr.
Sharad. Sorry.
Complete.
Maheshwari sir, please. Maheshwari sir, you were answering.
You'll carry on later on then.
Okay, okay. Dr. Hemant, you can go ahead.
Is it clear right now, sir?
Not yet, actually.
It's okay. You can start. You can see it.
You can start it. No problem.
Yeah.
No problem.
Okay. So this the 23-year-old male. He had a trauma while driving a bike. He hit by a 4-wheeler. He sustained injury to the right knee. He had a right knee swollen with a painful and restricted knee movements. He presented to the emergency department. We had X-ray of this patient. So now we have the X-ray of this patient with AP and lateral view. Looking at these X-ray, I would like to ask from the panelists, like, do we have like need something else for this patient, or straight away we can conserve this patient?
Hemant, your slideshow is not working. So on your normal slide, just click on the third slide. Yes.
Yeah. It's clear now, sir?
Yes.
So, sir, looking at this X-ray, is it clear right now?
Yes.
Yeah, please go ahead. Go ahead.
So, sir, looking at this X-ray, can we comment on do we need further evaluation of this patient, or can straight away we can conserve this patient? Anyone from the panelists, like
Hitesh sir, can you please take this?
Hitesh sir,
Dr. Hemant, can we continue for lack of time, or because we're getting short of time? Yeah. So just CT present the next fact and then we come and discuss it.
Okay, sir.
CT scan dikha do, uske baad kar.
Yes, CT ke baad.
Okay, sir. So this patient has in lateral view has the discontinuity in the medial condyle tibial slope. There was a fragment which was anteriorly displaced. So definitely he was having some trauma and fracture involvement in the proximal tibia. So we had a CT scan for this patient. In CT scan, we found like 3D and 2D scan, there was a anterior medial part of the proximal tibia was avulsed, or it was depressed also in the 2D scans we can see. And there was also alteration in the tibial slope with significant displacement of this fracture. So this holds a one indication for the surgical management of this patient. We gave a slab support for this patient due to the soft tissue injury was there, contusion was used. So we wait for one week for this patient. So within this with this 1 week time, we thought whether we can conserve this patient. So that's the out of question now. So do we need any further evaluation or not? These injuries which are involving the anteromedial part of the proximal tibia, they are due to basically due to the hyperextension knee hyperextension injury with the varus force of the knee joint, and usually they have some soft tissue involvement. They may be having some ligamentous injury associated. And considering the patient's sports oriented profile, we had further evaluation in this patient, and we got the MRI for this patient. And luckily, the patient was fortunate enough. He was not having associated ACL or PCL tear. Lateral collateral ligament was also intact. Fortunately, the superficial MCL was also intact. The deep MCL was attached to the anteromedial margin of the proximal tibia, and it was displaced along with the fracture. To our surprise, the meniscus was excluded in this case due to the avulsion of the anterior horn of the medial meniscus along with the fragment. So this forms another indication for surgical management of such fractures, which are though atypical in presentation, but needs surgical management, not a conservative treatment. So we took a classical anteromedial standard approach. We dissected to the superficial fascia. We retracted the superficial MCL posteriorly. And this is the window which we can easily get through this approach, and entire displaced fracture fragment can be seen through this. And similar to the posterior wall fracture in acetabulum, these fracture fragments also have the capsular attachment, margin of the capsula is attached to them. The moment we evert them superiorly, we can see everything inside the joint, and we can see the depressed fragment easily. Under view, we can elevate the fragment using the bone punch, and we can maintain the depression using the screws, and we can put the structural bone graft. Sorry, I forgot to ask the panelists.
Maheshwari sir, your take on this, how would you fix this fracture?
Yeah, so as you can see, the fragment is very small. Obviously, it needs open surgery. You have to open the joint. Meniscus can be lifted almost, and then have to reduce the fracture subchondral bone nicely. The issue here is the fragment is just too small. You need two things. You need to compress it as well as buttress it, because you need a very perfect hairline reduction, because this is a medial joint, takes most of the weight. So if it is too small, sometimes when you put normal screws, it can just shatter. I don't know. So I'll try to see if the fragment is good enough. Take two cancellous 4 millimeter screws, to compress this fragment to the main bone and then neutralize with something like a forearm plate to just let it be there. If the fragment is really too small and I think it will shatter, I'll keep a endo button, you know, from my ACL set, the endo button out and something like a tightrope where you can put a tightrope or use that as a compression device, because otherwise sometime you can mess up this case, because if you put two screws and it shatters, then you're gone. So it all depends on the size of the fragment, but I think this will take two screws. It appears to me like that.
Samarth, this is actually a fairly decent case for using a rim plate. So take a 3.5 recon plate. You really got to keep sort of twisting and turning it till you actually get it to fit and fix the two ends of the screw. And then you can put a small plate at the bottom for the as the buttress, but the rim plate would work quite well in this.
Yes, sir. So Hemant, can you show what you have done here?
We've seen it.
For fragment specific fixation, we have used a 2 mm low profile plates for the routinely we are using for the compact hand in the compact handset, and we have rafted the depressed fragment and stabilized the small fragments. And as we know, this plate is very low profile, so we need something strong to start the early weight bearing. So we have used the 3.5 T plate to buttress the entire construct just anterior to the superficial MCL to give a early range of motion and partial or non-weight bearing for 6 weeks. Then later on, we can early weight bear on this patient. So this is the 2-year follow-up of this patient. We can appreciate how is the slope of the tibial condyle has been restored. The medial tibial slope has been restored well. The articular depression is also doing well. And that's the 2-year follow-up of this patient. Patient is a basketball player. He resumed his playing and he's having good range of motion. Almost he's doing everything. So in addition to all these cases, we have one more case where we have a anteromedial part of the proximal tibia, which is also fractured here. And similar to this management, instead of using two plates where we are putting low profile, then we are adding on 3.5 buttress plate. We can also use arthrodesis plate of the foot, which can also help in as the profile of these plates is good and the mechanical strength is better as compared to the 2 mm compact handset plates. So these plates can also be used in a fragment specific manner and they give a good result. This case is also 35-year-old female. This is the next severe extent of these kind of hyperextension injuries where hyperextension started with involvement of the anteromedial part of the proximal tibia where it continued to involve the posteromedial or entire medial condyle of the tibia. And as we know, as the various forces continue, there is an injury to the lateral collateral ligament, which has been obvious here by the avulsion of the lateral fibular head or avulsion over here. So in this case, as in continuation with previous cases, the same approach, we need to fix the posteromedial condyle first, fix it properly with the buttress plate, either the posteromedial, ideally the posteromedial could have been better here, but to avoid two incision to put address the anteromedial fragment simultaneously, we opted for the anteromedial fixation and percutaneously we have fixed the fibular head fracture, and the same manner we have used the compact foot set plates to stabilize or to lift up the anteromedial depression fragment over here. So to conclude, I can say these atypical marginal fractures are very rare. They are not well described fracture of the proximal tibia and they need careful evaluation under anesthesia. I know we are not doing MRI routinely for all the proximal tibia cases. And these are the injuries which are most of a twisting injury and axial loading. And these are the cases where we have a marginal avulsion fractures. One need to give a thought towards the evaluation of the ligament injury. When we are operating on this patient there and there, then we can do a thorough examination under anesthesia to rule out any collateral injuries or any anterior or posterior accessory in this patient. If we not addressing those problems, it may be a problem in future because the implant is there. It will be not possible to repair or reconstruct the other ligaments at the second stage. And preoperative MRI in these cases may play an important role if we have a at least 1 or 2 week span before going for the operation. And obviously this extruded meniscus is also a great challenge. If we are not aware about this condition, then definitely we may fix the displaced fragment, but we may not be able to address this meniscus part, which may lead to the early onset arthritis in young patients. And definitely fragment fixation, specific fixation is must in all these cases where we have a small fragment routinely we can't use, or typical available plates for these patients. So I would like to thank you at last.
Thank you, Dr. Hemant, for that rare case series. Can I please request Dr. Abhishek to put up his next case? Meanwhile, can we have a comment from Dr. Maheshwari, sir, on the fixation of these cases?
One issue, this is a very difficult fracture. One issue is you two don't have so much space to put too many implants because there is an MCL there. So, and also it can cause late impingement and pain. So one thing is sure, you have to have a very accurate intra-articular reduction, number one, and you cannot let this fracture go into varus. Sometimes there is not much space. I don't hesitate to put a extra-articular external fixator for a period of 4 weeks, just to not let it go into varus. If you don't have too much space to put too many implants there, which have their own side effects, then you can bank on a external fixator on the medial side to prevent varus. And that's how this will heal in its own place and will not lead to late varus. Imagine, even if 1 or 2 degree varus happens here, this patient is ready for a ITBL osteotomy sooner than later. So you have to make sure intra-articular reduction is right. You don't have any varus at the end of the surgery.
So with take care of this depression fragment leg? We need something to support the depression fragment.
So first, you do an intra-articular reduction, fix it with whatever, 1 or 2 screws, maybe wires, but you're not sure that it will not collapse as you start finishing the operation. So either you put a buttress plate if there is enough space, no problem. But sometimes there's not much space, there's MCL there. If you put too many implants, MCL gets irritated and it causes pain, the patient loses movement and causes persistent pain. You have to remove the implant. I've removed implant in at least 2 such cases. And so sometimes I avoid putting too many implants there. I rather use a, you know, neutralization effect of the fixator, because sometimes you can't put too many implants there.
But we were lucky, sir, in this.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Samar.
Thank you, Dr. Hemant.
Dr. Samar.
Dr. Abhishek. Yes, sir.
There is a question, a comment from the audience. Can I take it before the...
Yeah, sure, sir.
Sure, sir.
Okay, this is a comment from Dr. Ramnik Mahajan for Dr. Pushkar case. He's telling that the problem is posterior plate and screw in flexure side actually does not allow reduction, causing widening proximally and causing varus. Hence, before putting the screw, check for widening, hold with wires and then plate. You can use a wire rim mesh here also. Dr. Pushkar.
Sir, listening, sir. Thank you, Ramnik, sir, for asking this question. So we have temporarily fixed only that fragment, so that we will be able to reduce the medial side, because we know that medial side needs to be reduced first and posterior medial needs to be reduced first to avoid any varus. So we have not fixed on the lateral side. It was my mistake. I will say that I missed that varus there, but next time, as the Maheshwari sir has said, that I will not do this again. Anything?
What about the wire mesh? Can you use that?
No, sir. Not use the switch. I have not used. Any other faculty have used that wired mesh? Anywhere?
No.
I don't think so. Sir.
Okay. We can go to the next talk.
Sir, thank you.
Dr. Abhishek.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay. On the outset, I would like to thank DOA for giving me this opportunity. I will come directly to the case. So this was a 30-year-old gentleman who was laborer by occupation, met with a high-velocity trauma. He sustained trauma to both his lower limbs. On presentation, he was conscious with GCS of 15. There was swelling around both the knees. There were no open wounds. And there was no distal neurovascular compromise. These were the x-rays. This was the right side. We can see it's a A2 fracture with a patellar two-part fracture. And also, this is the left side. So can I have some comments from the panelists, please?
You want me to comment?
Yes, please.
Can I ask Dr. Sharad to comment on it, sir? Dr. Sharad, are you there, sir?
Yeah, Dr. Samarjit, did you ask me? Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So there are two classes. Dr. Sam, can I have the first X-ray?
Yes, sure, sir. This is the right side.
Right. So we have seems to be extra articular fracture, or the line going to down to the articular margin as well?
No, sir, it's an extra articular fracture, though yes. CT was not done for this patient.
CT was not done, but this line is going down to the articular margin. Maybe the that patella shadow is coming at the pulpar.
Yes, you're right, sir.
Right, and of course, comminuted patella is there. So this type A fracture, and on the other side, again, and this again, we'll have to confirm. I think definitely we should confirm by a CT whether it's going intra-articular or not. But seems like supracondylar fracture, but severely comminuted, as you very correctly labeled as A3. So, is there any compounding in these?
No, sir, there is no compounding.
So, obviously, we need to fix them. Now, the question would be when and how. It will depend on general condition. As you said, the GCS score was 15, so there is no alarm on that side. That, then we have to decide about the local part, whether how is the skin there, and is there any blister formations or in
condition? So the skin in condition was good, sir. There was no blistering, and it was quite supple.
And then in case we are fit to go, then the next, whenever our next OT is, maybe next day or day after, we'll have, like to go for fixation. And for fixation, the right side, the option would be a nail, a retrograde nail, because we have sufficient part of the metaphyseal part with the distal fragment. We can go retrograde nail or a plate, a lateral plate. We can work here. There is no significant medial combination, so we can get away with either of the, depending on the surgeon choice. For me, I would probably go for a lateral locking plate. And what we do normally is we open at the distal part and just slide the plate submuscular and come and hook the screws in the proximal part. The way Dr. Trikha has described, giving sufficient margin between the two screws. And the same thing on the other side, we reduce it and keep in under alignment. The option would be if you can just put a traction and then align it, or we put a sort of an external fixture or something to get an alignment, then put a plate, pass it submuscular, and idea is to get a reasonable alignment and then bypass this comminuted fragment and fix it with the locking plate.
And sir, what about the patella on both the sides?
Patella, of course, will have to be, can we see the...
So this is the right side? And... Yeah.
So we need to, seems to be a little comminuted, but since there looks like a distal pole mainly, so we can maybe get away with partial patellectomy in here. And the other side, we need to address patella as well. This seems to be severely comminuted. Maybe patellectomy would be a better idea.
Right, sir. So these were the concerns for this patient when I took this up, according to. So what would be the plan? As you rightly said, sir, you prefer plating for both the sides. Should we do it staged versus simultaneous, sir?
Can I make a comment?
Sure, sir.
I think the key to treatment of both these knees is patella fracture. This knee is destined to become stiff, come what may. So whatever you do, this knee has to be moved next morning. Now, how do you do? What do you do? You have to decide. Which means I'm coming to say, as far as possible, I will nail both sides because it is much easier to mobilize a knee with a nail. Obviously, on this side, probably it's not good. I may add a plate with a nail. But whatever I do, I must move these knees very soon, whether I do partial patellectomy or full patellectomy or, you know, whatever. If I don't move this knee because of the reason of patella, this will become stiff. So I think patella fracture decides the fixation. It has to be rather strong fixation. In my hands, nailing is a better option. Maybe on this side, at least nail with a plate.
And so what about grafting?
So any you may or may not graft. You may not, it all depends. If it is not a compound fracture, you may not graft it primarily. All these fractures just heal up when you align them very well.
Dr. Maheshwari, can I ask something? Yeah. Whether you plate or nail, you can if you just don't think of patella, you can mobilize it next day. They're not going to change the mobilization part.
I agree with you, but still between the two, Nail is a better mobilization device, number one. Number two, plate is always very bulky. It sits on the lateral condyle of femur. That's why we are going away from plate now. Because plate is, unless it sits and hugs the lateral condyle of femur absolutely 100%, it causes stiffness. There's a plate impingement because iliotibial band drops over the plate. So any deterrent to nice gliding of the patellar retinaculum on the femoral condyles is a deterrent to knee movement and causes stiffness. In this case, there is already one factor, which is patellar fracture. So I think you can mobilize even with plating. I agree with you, but it is unless it is done very well, it sits exactly there. It's a problem compared to nailing.
Abhishek, what have you done,
sir? Because of lack of time.
Right, sir. So this was what was done for the right side. We did simultaneous surgery for both the sides. So this was done for the right side along with patellar TBW. And this was done for the left side. Can I have some critical comments about this X-ray?
Trika, sir, can you please give your comments on this X-ray?
Can you just stop? Dr. Vivek around? Dr. Vivek Trika? No, I think he's not there. Dr. Samarth, can you comment on the fixations? Idea, any other change in fixation?
Vivek has joined.
No, I think he's not there now.
Sir, I would have, if I were to do this case, I would have probably tried to nail this case like Dr. Maheshwari has said, but because I think it is an extra-articular fracture, even the screws distally are only on the lateral condyle, they're not going up to the medial condyle. But if I was to use a plate, then I would probably use a longer plate with lesser density of screws, approximately, like which Dr. Vivek Trika has already told in his talk very clearly. And I would have probably done a minimally invasive approach. So I would probably not have used a fibular graft here.
Right.
And why, are the screws only in one condyle?
Yeah, it's probably because of the imaging was not available. So okay. I agree that they should be lesser. And any comments about the medial plate augmentation in this case?
So with a nail, I think a nail is more stronger implant than a plate. With a nail, it gives better construct. If even after putting a nail, I think I have problems with the fixation, then I would probably agree with Dr. Maheshwari and I would add on a lateral plate. I would not open these fractures up because I think biology here is the key. In such comminuted metaphyseal fractures, if you preserve the biology on the medial side, they heal really well. You will see a lot of callus formation in these patients if you don't open them up at 4th to 6th week. And with a nail or a periosteal plate, supraperiosteal plate on the lateral side, in both those cases, I would preserve the biology on the medial side. I would not go in for a direct medial plate. Maheshwari, sir, would you put in a medial plate here if you were to plate fracture?
No, no. With a nail, which is a good intra main support, I will maximum put one more lateral plate. Medial side, I'll keep biological because it will heal up very well. All the fragments will have periosteum. I don't want to touch them.
Dr. Samarji,
Dr. Hitesh and Dr. Rakesh Mishra has a question.
I just wanted to ask Dr. Hitesh, any concept of fibula into the canal? Is he in for it or not with it? Dr. Hitesh, unmute yourself, sir. Unmute yourself.
On the left side, I will use an intramedullary fibula. I use it as a nail in the proximal and the distal fragment and hold it with a plate. And if we do patellectomy, I don't think the movement will be an issue. If we do a complete patellectomy, they don't get stiff.
I have a query. This is more of a more rigid construct. With such sort of a combination, you want a more rigid construct or more fanned out sort of a fixation?
More fanned out.
Yeah,
I think two to three times the comminuted fracture size. Comminuted length, the nails, the plate
should
length.
Need to. I think we need to use a longer plate. And
this being said, how would we rehabilitate the patient post-op, means regarding the weight bearing and the range of motion? Should we do immediately and delay the weight bearing?
I think you will have to mobilize them one way or the other. So it's going to be a toe touch weight bearing, but you'll have to be doing toe touch for a good about 2 months or something like that.
But sir, he's bilateral. This case is he's a bilateral.
Oh, sorry, I apologize. So he's on a wheelchair, boss. He's doing a bed to chair only.
Abhishek, just a comment. Movement around the knee is knee bending and straightening is quite effective. That's only what we need for initial mobilization. He may be bound to the bed or wheelchair because he has a bilateral injury, but we can start the early mobilization like knee bending slowly. My only comment is because on the one side there was an extra-articular fracture. How did you approach your patella there? You have done a tension bend wiring also. So how did you approach with the same lateral approach doing a tension bend wiring, or you have exposed another incision for the
patella? So what we did, we extended the lateral incision a little bit anteriorly, and then we could approach the patella. And on the left side, we did there were a lot of chunks of bone, so we removed a lot of them, and then we sutured it with Ethibond and repaired the retina.
Only suggestion. Because you want to fix it to your patella, so why don't you just open up your patella and go through that patella and do that nailing. And then trans patellar approach, and then go through and then start fixing your patella to close up your patella also.
That's a good thing.
Sir, can we go to the next one? Because we have two more cases and 15 minutes given by Dr. Dhawan. So I think, Dr. Sumit, can you upload your slide, sir? Yeah, sorry to interject.
उसका रिजल्ट तो बता देते यार जुड़ तो गया ना
सर बाद में करेंगे डॉक्टर सुमित प्लीज अपलोड
ओके
डॉक्टर वैश हैज टू
डॉक्टर महेश्वरी कैन यू आंसर माय क्वेश्चंस व्हिच वाज लेफ्ट एट दैट टाइम
ओके क्विकली देयर टू थिंग्स वन इज इनस्टेबिलिटी एंड सेकंड इज ऑस्टियोआर्थराइटिस द मोस्ट प्राइमरी थिंग इज इनस्टेबिलिटी फॉर व्हिच द लैटरल रिम ऑफ द लैटरल कंडाइल ऑफ टिबिया हैज टू बी अंडर द फीमर. If that doesn't happen, it becomes an unstable knee. Patient cannot walk. The second is osteoarthritis, which will take maybe, if it is a valgus alignment, it will take maybe 15-20 years, which you can kind of, you know, be a little bit casual. But if the rim is under the femoral condyle, that kind of a depression, 2-3-4 millimeter, really does not make much difference, because in the knee, 60-70% of the weight bearing happens on the medial side. So lateral condyle, though one wants to be absolutely accurate, but weight bearing is more important. Stability is more important.
I think let Dr. Sumit start and we can discuss later on. That is, Dr. Sumit, please.
Yeah, is it visible?
Yeah.
Good evening, everybody. I am presenting an interesting case of floating knee with Hopa's fracture. And I would thank Dr. Lalit Maini for providing me with the case details. So to start the brief case, the case is a 45-year-old gentleman who met with a road traffic accident, and he had obvious head injury, and there was a gross swelling of soft tissues around the left. Vitals were unstable at the time of presentation that responded to resuscitation, and head injury was planned to be treated by non-operative management. So patient could not be optimized till 18 days, and after that was taken up for surgery. Meanwhile, radiographs and the CT scans are being displayed for your perusal. So this is the X-ray of floating knee. It is an extended definition of floating knee. And as we are facing the problem of distal femur and the proximal tibia in our webinar today, and we had both the problems together with us. So we, as the other faculty have suggested, that CT scan is must for all these cases. We got this CT scan done and were surprised to see additional finding of longitudinal fracture of the patella in addition to the lateral tibial plateau, and there was large medial condyle, and the HOFA was there on the lateral femoral condyle. In addition, the HOFA was comminuted as well. As we can see here, the three fragments are. So a multiplanar reconstruction also confirmed the same findings. And here has been suggested that it was a large lateral fragment of the tibial plate as the apex. So apart from the AO classification system that have been just shared, There are other means by which we can classify it. To start with, there is a Fraser injury for the floating knee, and the present one comes under 2C type of Fraser injury, and which is the most difficult to manage and the least common of all. And there was another thing in our hand that was a Hofer's fracture, and we classified it at Latenour classification, where we saw this thing as a type 2 type of fracture. The type 1 and type 2 differentiation is quite important, because type 1 can be classically fixed with the anterior, anterior-posterior sort of leg screw fixations, whereas as the fragment goes down in size, especially if it is less than 2.5 centimeter in dimension, we may need
Smith, to... Can I suggest we should stick to the case only, boss?
I'm coming on to that. So at times we may go for posterior to anterior in these small fragments sort of scenario. So we planned the surgery, and after 18 days, the patient was taken up, and it was operated with extensile approach on the anterior side. Here we can see that the Hofer fracture was fixed from posterior to anterior with the help of the leg screw, and all the three fragments could be purchased in that. And apart from that, the fixation on the tibial side was also obtained. So this was the immediate post-operative X-ray, where we can see that the medial condyle was lagged with the multiple leg screws, and the Hofer was fixed with a leg screw also. Apart from the screws on the lateral side, a buttress plating was added on the lateral side of the tibial plateau. And this is the 3 years follow-up, and the patient was having 90 degree range of motion, though there was obvious early degenerative arthrosis that was setting up in the anterolateral chamber. And as of now, the patient was doing well without any pain.
Gurinder sir, your take on this?
The femur was a partial articular.
It's a large medial condyle with the Hofer's of the lateral side, sir.
Yeah.
There is no plate applied on the femur at all.
Plate was not applied because we had two things in mind, and the surgery was being done under tourniquet. And since the fragment on the medial side was large enough, we fixed the fragment with four leg screws, and the rest of the thing on the lateral side was done by the leg screws.
You definitely made it work, and I think what you use is anterior swashbuckling kind of an approach, right? Yeah. Anterior medial parapetal arthrotomy karke.
Yeah.
Okay. So I mean, you definitely made it work, but normally I would still have. I know it's a partial articular on that side. I still would have liked to put a plate. I mean, you've done very, very well. Can't deny you the success. But I would have done it slightly different.
Sir, plate on what surface would you have applied? Medial surface or lateral surface, sir?
So I would definitely have, the medial side definitely would have put. And in fact, I think I would have put a small plate on the lateral side as well. Both sides I would have put a plate.
And what about the patella? Anything was done for the patella?
Since the patient was operated 18 days later and was having head injury also, so as the swashbuckler approach was developed and the patella was, we started retracting it medially, then we did not find any displacement. So it was practically uniform that we found.
Patella looks very good.
Sir, your take on use of a slab post-operation?
So I think... you know, obviously try to avoid it, but you know, if you used only a screw fixation, you would need to give some sort of immobilization. You will not be able to mobilize them straight away. That's one reason why I would have put a plate. But your reduction is brilliant.
Maheshwari sir, your take on this?
Why is this in the post-op period? Is it a aged patient? Because I can see a lot of degenerative arthritis already.
He was 45-year-old gentleman, and as we can see, there was no apparent
Yeah, it looks quite good here, but in the immediate post-op X-ray, maybe it is an X-ray.
I think it's just the X-ray, boss. I think the back slab wagera ke karan.
Yeah. Some arthrosis later on. We can see at 3-year follow-up. But as of now, he's asymptomatic for these changes.
Yeah, I would have used a plate, but nothing succeeds like success. It is done very well. That's okay.
Thank you, Dr. Sumit. So next up, we have Dr. Bedi, who would be presenting his case on a complex distal femur fracture. Sir, if you could share your screen, please.
नहीं किसी की स्क्रीन अटकी हुई है यार
या इट्स माइन आई एम कमिंग
सुमित सर यू नीड टू स्टॉप शेयरिंग
या
ओके सो दिस इज अ गाय हुज इन्वॉल्वड इन इज अ वेरी यंग 26 ईयर ओल्ड गाय गेट्स इन्वॉल्वड इन आरटीए ही इज ऑन अ मोटरसाइकिल बम्प्स इनटू अ कार इट्स एन ओपन फ्रैक्चर इट्स एक्चुअली अ फ्लोटिंग नी बिकॉज़ टेक्निकली ही इज गॉट अ सुप्राकॉन्डिलर इंटरकॉन्डिलर फ्रैक्चर फीमर He's got a diaphyseal fracture of the tibia. So he's in some other city. He gets operated. He initially gets a nailing done of the tibia and fixed for the femur. In a few days' time, he comes back. They take him back because they're slightly worried about the infection. After a few days, they take him back and then they go and put a plate on it. And that's what the plate looks like, which has been put. So they've actually divided the femur. So a lot of bone actually falls out at the time when it's done. So this is when he comes to us, that 6 weeks down the line. So this is the X-ray which we had. So the worry when we looked at the X-ray was we couldn't really see the notch quite well. And it didn't look, you couldn't see the profile of the condyles. That's what we got slightly worried. His wound was fairly well healed. Remember, it's 7 weeks down the line. So that's the reason why we actually got our first impulse on seeing this was, well, let's wait and see how we develop, because he just come for an opinion. But because of this profile of the condyle, we decided to get a CT scan done, and sure enough, can you have a look at that step which is being produced between the two condyles? So it's actually a front-to-back reduction which has been done, which is obviously not going to be fine. The other thing is, screws actually going through the notch itself, so it's going to impinge on the ACL and everything, and cause problems when he tries to mobilize his knee. So that's when actually we decided, look, we need to redo this fixation given his young age and all. So there was, as I said, no evidence of this thing. The other problem was, there's a lot of gap which you could see in the comminuted area. And you're worried that without a bone-to-bone contact, he would not actually unite. So we went ahead with a view that we will go ahead, correct the alignment, dock it up, and see what we can get to. We'd already seen that his leg was slightly short, but that was not something that was top of our mind. So we're just going to wait it out and see how he went. So this is the redo fixation that we did. I know the view looks as if we haven't got the contact, but we had a CT scan which showed that it worked well. So we actually ended up, by the time we collapsed it, we actually ended up shortening it up even more. But we got a good enough fixation. Young guy, good fixation, long plate. So fairly happy. And we thought, look, we didn't really poke around too much in that comminuted area. We just went ahead with the idea, isko thoda compress kar denge, but not go and debride that comminuted area. We thought, it's been debrided, so there's no point doing it again and again. So, but I mean, the patient was allowed to mobilize, toe touch bearing only, and he kept on coming back every now and then. So 6 months down the line, this is the X-ray that we've got. So there is good enough fixation. None of the screws has got loose. This is where we stand at 6 months time. Very quickly, Samarth, what did you do at 6 months? I'm just going to keep it very short. You got to unmute.
I think, sir, this is going into a non-union, and if we don't do something right now, it is going to fail. Either the plate is going to break or the screws are going to come out.
Absolutely. I think we had the same problem. So the concern in our mind was, should we just go and graft it, which was one option because we thought the plate was looking good. No screws have got loose. He's got scarred up area, both from the injury and two operations. The second option was, should we go and put a medial plate? The third option was, look, this has still got a big gap in it. We need to compress it. Should we go ahead and excise some of that fibrous to in between and collapse it more? What would you do, Samarth? Sorry, I'm just going to keep it between you and me now.
Sir, if I was to do this, I would just open it up, clean out all the fibrous tissue, put in a lot of graft there. If I think the fixation is not stable, then I would add on a medial plate. Otherwise, a lot of graft there, sir.
Okay, so we went ahead with the idea that look, let's graft it because the plate looks okay. And I know somebody would have said, look, you should have added. Our problem that we thought was that biology was failing us. So this was an open injury. The fragments were looking very necrotic. So we didn't want to make another incision on the medial side to support it. So our plan was, let's graft it and do it. So what we have done a few cases, I'm sure we are not the only ones doing it. We actually go in with an arthroscopic shaver and we go in, poke it into that area where the bone, this thing is, and we use the shaver, the bar of the shaver, create a little, almost like a hole, and, you know, it's actually, you're making a mush out of things out there, and then, you know, using a little curette in there, so that's a curette which you can see actually going inside, that's the shaver which is going inside, cleans up that area, and you make a little, this thing. Then we took BMP, the Medtronic's cup BMP, we added it to the graft which was there, and through the small hole, the incision is about 1.5 centimeters only, just enough to poke a funnel and put the graft inside. And that's what we did. And we thought, look, maybe it's going to unite with this. I understand some people would say we could have gone more aggressive, but that's what we did. So 9 months down the line, he comes. He's actually walking very well, very little pain, fully weight bearing. But when you look at the x-ray, that's what the x-ray looked like at that stage. So it didn't look at all as if it's going to unite at all in there. So whatever bone we had put, I don't know what it was doing out there, but definitely not uniting the bone.
Gurinder, how did you allow him walking?
We allowed him to walk because, you know, his pain kept on going down. So we said, look, carry on with walking. Frankly, our this thing was, fixation is good. If he loaded, maybe he'll throw more bone. That was what was there in our mind.
I think some screws are broken.
No, no screw was.
After 6 months, this plate is a potential breakage or bending here. I don't think you can allow any kind of weight bearing, even with a medial plate. I would have put a medial plate in a graft, and still I would have not allowed a weight bearing here. Mm. This is a very, actually, very strong area.
I think I am actually fairly aggressive on weight bearing because you really hardly keep anybody who's not weight bearing, because we do believe that you can actually stimulate osteogenesis with weight bearing. I know. You would say it's a foolish plan, but that's what we've done till now. And again, it's few failures. So this is where we are now. Now we stuck because now about 9 months have gone by since our surgery, and it's definitely not uniting at all. And the other problem was the patient is already short by about 3.5 centimeters and he's got a non-union. And the best plan that I have is go ahead, take it out, make him even more shorter and compress it, put a medial plate, put more graft and all. The patient is unfortunately he's very sort of sick because, you know, he thinks my leg is already short and now you're going to tell me that you're going to shorten it by another about 2 to 3 centimeters. You're not even actually telling me that it's definitely going to unite. You said you were trying to make it unite and I'm losing my earnings and everything. So do something, but you can't leave me with 5 centimeters of shortening. What's the solution at this stage, Dr. Maheshwari? I know I can go and collapse it.
So idea of shortening is absolutely no for me.
Okay.
Young guy, even first time I would have not shorted him. I want
he came with a debrided fragment.
But even if I would have maintained his length in the first sight, not at all I'm worried about the gap. I will use a fibula anytime to bridge the gap. So I will add biology as well as plate, but eventually after 6 months, 9 months, 1 year, this fellow should have a normal leg, at least lengthwise.
Right.
I've not shortened it at all, no question.
Ab kya karoge? Now you can't, a non-union, you can't even distract it now.
Fibula. I will use the fibula and add a medial plate.
Boss, frankly, can I say that would be a bad decision? For a simple reason, in a non-union, you cannot go with the idea that I'm going to distract the non-union, put a fibula, put this thing and make it. There is no question at all that non-union needs compression. You can do whatever, whether it's a subproctor.
Not all non-union needs compression. I'm telling you,
I'm not aware of even one which doesn't need
compression. Maintain the length.
Nahi, boss. Isme I would disagree.
We'll disagree, but we'll continue because we have shorter time.
Okay.
So please carry forward.
So here we go. So our solution to this was, we know we had this plate was not working. So we know we had to do something about this. So the thing that we could do was, we could actually put a small Elizaro in there and compress it. Plus, we would put an X-Fix in there, an Orthofix monorail, distract it, but knowing fully well that no femoral lengthening is fraught with a lot of problems because you need to leave the Orthofix for a period of somewhere about 9 months or something to get that 4.55 centimeters of lengthening, which you need to do. So we actually went ahead and actually designed a nail, which is this nail that you can see. We designed it to go in from that, from the what you can see from the tip to just about there, leaving enough room for a Elizarro ring there. Plan being to put a fixator and do a lengthening over a nail. So you just need to go with the idea that you're customizing it, knowing fully well where will the nail be once you've done the distraction and the narrowing. So you got to calculate the thickness of the canal that you're going to have. You're going to calculate the length where you will be and where will it be when you distally
Dr.
lock
Gurinder,
it. So
a little bit of
planning which goes. Okay, planning. So this is the device that we actually put on him. There's a nail inside. There's an autofix fixator which is connected to the Elizarro. The Elizarro is actually holding this fracture. We corrected the alignment. By this time, it had gone to malalignment. We corrected the alignment, put the nail, put the autofix here, kept on lengthening it as it went. If you can see there, that's a gap which is created. Once we got the length right, then we went ahead and locked this nail there and removed the autofix from here. Initially, we actually did it all together. Removed the autofix, locked it, and removed the Elizarro at the same time. So this took a fair amount of time. So this is what it looked like when we removed everything. This bone united because we compressed it with the Elizarro. This bone was locked there, and it was locked distally as well. And
Doctor,
it actually went
ahead. Dr. Gurinder, please wrap up because we are just having...
I am. The knee was unfortunately gone stiff, so we did a quadriceplasty. That's what it looked like at the end. And the patient is now sort of walking and everything. Carry on. I'll take a question if you wish.
Dr. Samarjeet?
Yes, sir.
We have to wrap up now.
Yeah, I think very nice case, Dr. Gurinder. And a lot of efforts gone into making walk. Now, I think let's finish off this talk. And maybe carry forward some messages. I like Dr. Hitesh to sum up because we're really short of time.
It was a nice discussion and it was a great presentation by Dr. Vivek Trikha and Dr. Maheshwari. Very nice case presentation, had a lot of educational experience. And I got to sum up, I think Dr. Vivek Trikha laid down the new concepts that for A, B, C, for C fracture, C1 and C2, nailing is the best. And I think the whole orthopedics is coming around. In my senior incident, I plated, I had a distal patient would have a distal femur on both sides. And I plated one side and a nail on the other side. And the difference was very relevant. The nailing did better. And the nailing is coming around. And for C1, C2, the nailing is a good option. And I thank all the speakers and the faculty for making this good educational experience. Thank you.
Okay, I thank everyone, all the faculty, and my special thanks to Dr. Ashok Sham, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani, Dr. Shamshul Hota, and Dr. Ravi Chauhan. I thank everyone, and we will be meeting again on 14th of June, Sunday, for the part two. Dr. Shamshul?
Thank you, everybody.
Can I stop light, sir?
Yeah.